Hi everyone, welcome to today's episode of Dragon Schmance, Dragonlance, Shadow of the Dragon Queen, and possibly King. I mean, I don't know. I don't really know the royalty sort of line with the shadows.
The
I don't know. I've never read. I don't know how to read, you guys. I didn't know that was a thing to play D&D. Good morning, chat. Good morning. And we're already coming into a hype train that's pretty cool. Hi, guys, gals, non-binary pals. Welcome in to a very special episode of Dragonlance, where TPKs are on the card, and I've asked the players to make backup characters just because you never know.
No, you haven't.
We have. Happy birthday, Rob, says chat from Mythical Turian. Happy birthday, Rob. Rob today turns 69. Nice. He just looks really good for a 69-year-old. Well done. You'll notice that Ollie is not here today. Dredd will be joining us hopefully at a later time. No rush. They had other things. So if they can get here, amazing. If they can't, we'll make it work. But
we'll just move on without him and never look back.
Rip. F's in chat. Okay, before
welcome.
We.
I love the Kari framing.
It just keeps breaking.
Love it.
Great.
It keeps breaking. I don't know why.
It's a really good shot of my chin.
It looks good. You know, you have a strong chin.
I've always said you have one of TTRPG's greatest chins.
There you go.
You know.
She's always said that.
I do have a female cleft chin. I have a female butt chin, which is quite rare. I'm real proud of it.
A female butt chin. You should be.
It's a cleft chin, and it's very rare for a female to have.
You
one.
Guys, no Dragonlance today. We're just going to talk about butt chins. Let's strap
and
in
we
for a little
shine
while.
The light on butt chins. You know, we have fun here at Dragonlance, but the most important thing is that we spread awareness.
This is an awareness stream about female butt chins.
All right,
don't be ashamed to have a butt on your face.
Never.
That's right.
There's some very famous actresses that have
I'm a butt
unless head. It's Satura.
Okay, well that took a turn.
Unless it's your grandma's birthday party, you know what I'm saying?
With that, let's go around the table quickly and introduce ourselves, our players, our characters. Let's start with, butts on our face. you know what? It's the birthday boy. Why don't we start with the birthday boy? Happy birthday, Rob. So many memories shared together since we were children. Why don't you share one of these memories and tell us a little bit about yourself?
Sure thing. So the first memory I have of Rackham was when we were 6 years old, because we're the same age. We're both 69.
Yeah.
Nice.
He looked like that already. Bald,
born with
bearded,
full beard.
6 years old, bald and bearded. It was crazy. Or at least he told me he was six. Anyway.
All right.
I'm Robert Hartley, GM. Hi, how's it going, everybody?
I love this.
I'm a professional Dungeon Master CTRPG player and full-time nerd, and you'll find me all over the internet at Robert Hartley, GM. You can also find me as the GM for a comedy group called Viva La Dirt League. And it's my birthday today, so Rackham's going to kill me on my birthday.
Probably.
Listen, you know, it's a good time for a rebirth. Well done.
It's the day you were born. It's the day you'll die.
Die.
Who would you rather die at the hands of? Like, somebody that you know and like, or some random person? Because today you get random person. Yeah.
I was going to say which one is
exactly. Corey,
you've killed the character of mine before, so it's
I have,
first.
And I was very gentle. But you won and lost. Do you know what I mean?
Gentle.
Uh-huh, uh-huh. Is this the tower thing?
No,
yeah, it was.
You've died twice.
Hello.
My name is AJ Winters. I am a world builder and dungeon master from Winters Tales. That is the studio that we are currently in. That Rob is visiting. We do TTRPGs and such, most predominantly our flagship show, The Chronicles of Aelwyn, on Tuesday nights, 8 p.m. AWST, and tonight I am playing Kori, the second half. Did you not say who you were playing? You just said
I'm playing,
that you're going to die?
It doesn't matter. I'm going to be dead soon anyway.
Oh, gosh. I'm playing the other half to the twins, Kori, and we are wizards.
Wizards.
Since Rob didn't mention that. Wizards! Yes.
Awesome. Next, we have the definite non-wizard of the family, Goose. Not
hey,
a wizard,
that's me.
Maybe other things. What's up? Something big just recently happened.
It did.
You got your first something big.
Pubic hair.
Well done.
Came in.
And we all got screenshots of it, too.
We got a beard first, weirdly.
This is taking a turn very quickly. Yeah, go ahead.
We had a big marketing event for Stray Gods, which is the game that I am very lucky to be on the team, the dev team for. We had a live performance of some of the songs that is part of the musical. It is a musical RPG. And we were finally able to announce the cast list, which involves Laura Bailey, Troy Baker, Ashley Johnson, Erica Ishii, Raul
so many
Coley,
people, so many people,
many people. It's very, very exciting.
You have to list all of them now, because otherwise they will see this and they'll get offended that you didn't list them.
Yeah, they all are fans of
Laura Bailey's coming for your ass.
Yeah,
they might not be fans, but I'm going to show them it. I'm going to go down the list and I'm going to send it to all of them.
It's okay, Rob forgot some of my players' names yesterday.
I did not. It was a bit.
Wow.
Wow. Ooh, it's a sore point.
It was a bit.
It's a sore spot, apparently.
So yeah, you can find that. There's the trailer is properly out now.
Best trailer I've ever seen in my life.
It's a really good trailer to kind of get the vibe of the game, which is very cool. So do that. Also, you can find me and places at Zach Speaks Giant. I do D&D stuff. You may be surprised.
Yeah.
Also, I play Goose for now.
All right. And just directly above from Goose is the team mom. Ellie, tell us about yourself and all things for you.
Yeah, absolutely. Hey, you can follow me on Twitter at LNKGraham1. Sometimes I cry tweet, which is always fun. When I watch something new, I tweet every time I cry. Watch out for when I finally crack into The Last of Us show, because you're going to be getting tweets every 5 seconds, I bet.
Probably.
So follow me there. You can see all the fun streams I'm in. You can find me on Sirenscape's Twitch channel every Friday with Cyberpunk Red. We're like 11 seasons and counting. It's really, really cool. We've got merch and all that cool stuff. I love that game. I love that group so much. And mainly, follow me at Roll to Cast. That's R-O-L-E. We are an Any-Winning Variety TTRPG podcast. We've got 8 seasons of content. Each season is a different game system, original story, original soundtracks, and we have cool new guests on different seasons. So we had a guest for our Avatar Legends seasons, my good friend Zola, who also directed my Fringe show. We've recently got Karma, a very, very great actor here in Adelaide, who is in our Starfinder season, which is cool. Currently releasing, and I will be running the next season. So follow Roll to Cast if you want some of that good TTRPG content. And if you're into children's theatre, my play Claire Della and the Moon will be hitting up the Dream Big Festival in South Australia very, very shortly at the end of May. And it will actually be touring to Perth in September. So stay tuned for that.
Everybody knows Perth is like near Darwin. So it's all good. Perfect. Right there. So Darwin, Perth. Everybody knows that. Sorry, keep going.
Sure, why not? Yeah, and I play Juniper, who is the team mum with a lot of guilt, having to raise her family almost single-handedly. And yeah, I love it. I listen to Mitski and cry before every session.
Love it. This is what I bring trauma to the people. That's what they wanted, right? Like,
Don't worry. BYO.
Yeah, bring your own knife.
So, Zach, when are you coming to Perth? Because Ellie's also going to visit. So now I've had Dredd in the studio, and Robin's here. Ellie's going to be in the studio. Like, Zach,
Going to duck over. I'm just going to duck over real quick.
Yeah, I hope so. Gonna be right, I'm going to hold you to that.
All right, and so today, so just sad news. Actually, interesting news. I didn't even run this by the cast, but I'm gonna do it. Freaking do it. So two things. One, tomorrow there's no stream for me or Friday because I'm on vacation. Woohoo! An actual family vacation. Woo-hoo! We haven't been on in God knows how long. So immediately after the stream, I'm gonna hop on a train and go to, I don't know, let's make it Perth. I'm on my way to Perth, by train.
Yeah!
Yay!
Come to me.
Across the Pacific. It'll be
Perth
a fun time.
Perth is now the capital of
in one
Australia.
Of those submarine trains.
That's right. Two, next Monday we have a special guest, or I have a special guest. My first evening stream, Eastern Standard Time, 6 p.m. Woo-hoo! EST. A new player, a new D&D player, and we lost Ollie again. If we could fix that, or
yeah,
Goose.
I don't know why that keeps happening.
It's okay. If somebody else can join on behalf, that would be great, maybe, or something, just to get it working, just to frame the cameras. And so, yes, so next week, Monday evening, a content creator by the name of Sukiyuki is joining us on a one-on-one D&D, and that was her preference, so we'll be doing that, and maybe it'll lead to more fun, but I'm very excited to get a brand new, I love new players, you know what I mean? There's nothing like new players that don't really know too much about D&D, because they have, like, they're not filled with all these preconceived notions of what you can and can't do, and they're usually a bucket of fun. And we had no submissions for fan art or anything this week. So, instead I decided that for the next session, I'm going to do a little thing.
Cool.
So, for you guys watching this today on Twitch Live, and for you watching on YouTube later, there's going to be a game. After the session is over, when I download the video and get it prepared for YouTube, 5 times in the stream, I will be putting a little doohickey, a little graphic that's going to appear somewhere on for like a couple of frames a few times throughout the video, so you'll need to be paying attention. The first person to email me, and I'll put that in the details of the video, the moments that you see that little icon appear, it's gonna happen 5 times. You let me know, you email me, I found it at this time, you'll win yourself a Talespire code for yourself. Evil Zach has entered the room. All right. if that's okay, I'll just boot this version of Ollie, and then
thank you.
Oops. Perfect. There we go. So that's going to be for the giveaways for next week. So keep a lookout. The video goes up on Saturday, so you have a few days to find all this little, and it's going to look like a little Easter egg. It's just going to be Easter egg, quite literally. I'm going to put it a few frames here and there. So keep a lookout. It won't be big, and you'll find it. Okay. With no further ado. We're going to jump into the trailer. There's no recap this week because, you know, I got sick. My kid got sick and I didn't have time, but it'll go up at some point, I promise. We're going to jump into the recap and then do the trailer and then right into the game. Here we go.
Boop, boop. Hell yeah. Boop, boop.
It has been 300 years since the gods punished the world of Kryn. They shifted continents, sundered nations, consumed empires. 300 years since the gods departed, ushering in the time of darkness. Yet nothing is eternal. The world begins to heal. Fragile nations rebuild, tentative alliances reforge. But in the shadows to the east, the drums of war sound. Will darkness consume the land, or will heroes stand in its way? Welcome to Dragonlance, Shadow of the Dragon Queen.
Whilst currently working with children, like maybe after the shift.
All right. And we're back. I love the little conversations that happen in between. It's really good. So, last time we played, the Hartman family had finally arrived at the outskirts of Calaman, having barely escaped through the skin of their teeth the situation in Vogler.
Mm-hmm.
Juniper Rose and Goose Tav, aka Goose, had made their way to the castle, and now Zach has disappeared, or is it just on my screen?
Zach's just walked away.
Oh, he just gave up. Yeah, he's like, you know what? I give up.
He's like, I'm done.
Yeah. I'll take his share of the profits.
Perfect. Zach instantly dies, and you get all the stuff. They had made their way to the castle, having been summoned and receiving a letter from one Cassandra, inviting them to come to the council. They dealt with that whole bucket of fish. Meanwhile, Corey, Lyndon, and Ollie decided to go take a gander with Aretheia at the library and go vibe and just find some books and do some things. Sadly for them, it seems that somebody had tipped Wyhan, a black-robed mage, to the presence of some undesirables, some questionables, some people who maybe shouldn't be here, or something like this, to that effect. Mysteries abound.
Mm-hmm.
And attempting attempting a rather intriguing and really clever ploy to dress up as one of the people that she knows, it kind of backfired when that ruse sort of fell apart. In an attempt to capture them, things turned violent. And yet, Ollie, Lyndon, and Corey, and Aretheia, and not Urethra, managed to, fine.
It's so close to Urethra. I laugh every time you say Aretheia.
She doesn't. She's very sad about the whole thing. You managed to escape.
She got bullied.
You and Ollie grabbing the unconscious forms, or just barely conscious forms now, back to Sabian's house, a nearby home that is fairly simple, that is a one-story building where no one thinks to come looking for them. In today's session, as Corey, you lay injured, heavily injured on the floor, you could see the world around you passing, voices kind of muffled. Just conversations happening. Erythia barely sitting up and grunting and moaning beside you. The form of Ollie still in woven shape, looming over, protectively pacing back and forth. Your mind goes unbeckoned and unprompted. It occurs to you. The date. And as your mind filters and winds back, the clock. You find yourself, the high squeaky noise as consciousness fades and you fall back, tired, exhausted against your very will, fading away. And we find ourselves in Corey's memory, a year ago to the date. You are remembering. And we see in a great hall and the large towers of sorcery. Let's change the map to represent this. Give me a second.
Ellie, give us our flashback sting.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't have a harp on me. Why did you ask me?
True. Bowser, give us our flashback sting.
Oh, no!
In this time, a year ago, the towers of high sorcery in Weyrith are not very well maintained, to the best of their ability. The world has changed. When the cataclysm hit and the world was unmade and destroyed for the greed and the hubris of the priest king, or the king priest, actually. But still, after the great cataclysm, a few buildings survived, a few countries remained. And this one, as far as you know, the remaining Towers of High Sorcery in Weyrith stays. Or stayed. This is the location where Lyndon, Corey were sent to learn their craft. And on this day, a couple of things about this tower. One, every room, it appears to be a fairly simple tower that spans a fairly large distance. It has a small campus around it. But every room within is not just a simple room. Demiplanes occasionally exist within these rooms. Places to practice your magic, places to try to master the arcane that is ever so fickle. And on this day, we start inside of the Great Hall, which, despite its name, is not so great. There are a number of students that stand here. Mm-hmm. And at the table that you are at, in this memory, let's take a look at this map. We have
little squiz,
a little thingy that we're gonna do here. We see a hall that is laid with tables with rather magically created food, some sparse food and some regular mundane food. A number of humans, kender, goblins, elves, and others wearing apprentice robes, wearing red, black, and white robes intermingling. And as we focus through, passing from the high table to the back of the chamber, we discover the following individuals. One in the corner, looking younger than he does today, is Lyndon. Sitting at the table, trying his best to focus on the book that he has in his hand, trying to memorize some kind of spell. Beside him, Eric, the gnome costumier. A friend of both Lyndon and Corey, who belongs to what the equivalent would be of the Glee Club or the Drama Club. Eric and Lyndon and Corey, i.e. Lilas at this moment, have become fast friends. All of them have been bullied relentlessly by Cassandra, and they have bonded over such events as to sort of team up. While magic is incredibly powerful and potent, it also has many gaping holes. It is often unreliable and often exacts a price. And the wizards of the towers often teach to rely on practical effects as opposed to just magic. And so disguise kits and others have proven to be incredibly useful. Muddling your voice, making sure that you can mimic sounds and other individuals' posture. While the disguise self spell is wonderful, it doesn't do anything for your voice, it doesn't do anything for your attitude, it doesn't do anything for your charisma, your presence. And Eric has a particular talent for those things. He's very good at making costumes, very good at disguising people. We see two other individuals at this table that we are not quite familiar with. And I'm going to ask for our Herengon friend to maybe introduce themselves today.
In character? Or?
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know what you sound like, so tell me a little bit about yourself.
I flirted with a northern accent this morning, and I
do it.
And I like maybe thought better do of it, but
do it,
do it, Callie.
All right, hang on, shush. All right, yeah, so the thing is, like, it's
yes.
crazy that you're here studying magic, but have you ever thought about the magic that exists within your own? I was going to say paws, but obviously you don't really have paws. You have hands, the weird kind of phalange things that you got. But like, that's what I'm here. I'm here to find out more about how magic can course through me old body. Do you get it? Are you with it? Are you going to finish your carrot juice?
No, you
can
have,
I have that. Yeah, great. And it's like, he's a wee fellow. Pipkin is. he's kind of like got an orangey fur, quite small, like around 3 foot. So is very much like dangling off the chair.
And in your hand is like, this big goblet of carrot juice, which
just
is
like a huge. It's just like, and you can tell he's got the jitters. Like he's. Maybe he should be cut off from carrot juice today, because he's like, his back paw is kind of like scratching up against,
yeah, thumper style.
Like, yeah, there's thumping that's happening.
Are you sure you should have another one? Is that? I mean, it's up to you. Obviously, it's just
panning to and asking the question. A diminutive dwarf, Zach, why don't you tell us a little bit about your character today?
Despite being physically larger than his Herengon friend, he takes up just an extraordinarily less space. He's got the bulky armor of a good dwarven family, but not the physicality to really wear it with confidence. He's sitting at the table, has pushed all the plates around him away, and is just kind of like getting bits and pieces and kind of like recombining them into different dishes in front of him, and like doing taste tests and just like kind of like really just making a mess of things.
What's his name?
Jackalby.
What is he?
Jackalby's from Invercargill.
Invercargill.
That's in New Zealand.
Perfect.
That's what I was gonna ask. Yeah. What's your name over there?
Yeah, Jackalby.
Okay. And how are you gonna take this carrot juice away from me? Huh? That's what I want to know.
Just pleasant words. My mum always told me you get more, you get further with honey, rock honey, then.
I imagine like
vinegar.
A paw just bops him on the nose.
Sure.
Oh, okay.
Across the table.
All right.
On this day, Lyndon, which you are disguised as Lilas and not looking like your traditional self, beside you, you're surprised to see something that you've quite literally never seen before. You know that on this day, the headmaster, the white-robed... What's their name again? Hang on. The actual canonin, Parsalian, who is this white-robed, the headmaster, P-A-R-S-A-L-I-A-N, doesn't matter. The headmaster, not Dumbledore, calls out and has announced to the students the day before that there would be a special event on this day. And so walking in, dressed unlike anything you've ever seen, Corey, why don't you tell us kind of what you look like today? As Eric has set you up.
I have been styled to be a flamenco dancer in a beautiful red dress with flared sleeves just like these.
Mm-hmm.
Hair styled in big, voluptuous blonde curls and red lipstick.
Amazingly, people are not looking at your face at all. Your long dress that is cut to the side. People will look at legs and not at face, apparently, on this day because they suck. Mm-hmm. And as you walk
in... Kari has a very, very high slit on that dress. Rockham designed this miniature and that thigh, though.
Listen, even Bowser's appreciative.
A lot of teenage boys at the school are having awakenings.
Yeah. A literal wolf whistle here from Bowser. Yeah.
And Lyndon does a double take and then head down to the book in front of him, pretends to be reading out some sort of ancient draconic or some kind of magic, but he's actually speaking in twin speak. He says, "The hell are you doing here?"
Kari replies, "It's an important day."
This was one of my days. Wasn't it?
Yes.
Oh, okay. I'm confused. Are we
students? Today, I have called when I have warned all of you. And you see Eric, your little friend, who I don't know what Ollie wants him to sound like, so I'm going to make an executive call. He sounds French for no reason. Hey, you look really good. You know, this perfect. I think super nice. What's up, Lilas? We have new friends at the table, by the way, and the headmaster bowls over what he's talking about. You can see the other tables with other individuals, other students of various ages, one of which is like this emaciated human who's always very cocky, Raceland something. He's very obnoxious and he's always, you know, sarcastically right about everything. But across the way, you see these humans, elves, dwarves at the other table beside you, Cassandra, surrounded by some of her sycophants. And as the headmaster is calling out, "Today we have a special task ahead of you. It is a special day of the year. I don't need to expand. Everybody knows what it is. Now, I have set before you a challenge of sorts. Something that amuses me. 3 items have been scattered about the tower. And I would like all of you to use your wits, your guile, your cleverness, your wisdom, your intelligence, whatever it is that you possess that makes you uniquely you, to retrieve 1, 2, or 3 of these items. I will be divvying up the whole into teams, and the team that either finds the most or all of these items will win a special prize on this day. Now, because... you know, we have a math nerd here. Some of these might be math-based nerd questions. But that's all right. And I'm sure everybody will enjoy those as much as everyone else.
Yeah, sure.
Now, he starts pointing at various tables across the hall. You bunch together. You bunch together. And he points to your table. You 5 together. You 4 together. And he moves on. Lumping, Jackalby, Pipkin, Lilas, Corey, and Eric as one group. Remember that violence can be the answer. I don't much care how you retrieve the item, though, you know, no killing, but, you know, knocking people out. We have mages on hand that will not heal, obviously, because that's literally impossible, but rather look after some nurses that will mend your wounds, but try to keep it at a minimum. You know, I do wear the white robes.
Impossible, yeah.
And with this, you may... Oh, one more thing. I have the note taker, the lore bearer, who will be following, taking notes, making sure you're not cheating. So I will be watching. Oh, and before I forget, here is your first clue. All right, you guys ready?
Yes.
Ready. So ready.
All right.
I imagine Pipkin may have already, like, bounded over the table when you were just like, ah, just before I go. And now it's just, like, sitting in the middle of the table, a bit sheepish.
In the middle of the table?
Yeah.
Got it.
Amidst yep. the gravestone of this place lie four plots, each with its own grace. One belongs to the warrior Bold, with stories of battles and treasures untold. The second plot, where magic's found, belongs to the wizard, now in the ground. The third is for the sage who knew life's mysteries and sought them through. The fourth plot, where wealth doth lie, belongs to the merchants, shrewd and sly. To find the treasure, choose with care and search for the plots that are rare. With your wits, you must devise and choose wisely to claim the prize. Now, in the areas in near the tower, there is one of the chambers possesses like a sort of mini village, if you will, of like where this cast or the teachers, I forget the term I'm looking for, the staff live, and some of their families live there. Some of the students will stay there. There's obviously a blacksmith. There's a cemetery. There is a room of like herbology, potions, alchemy classes. There are libraries and arcane rune studies. There is the history. There's a bunch of different rooms in this place, but this is the first clue that you've been given, and you immediately see a couple of people continue eating. They don't seem to care that much, but Cassandra's table immediately gets up, and the table of dwarves immediately gets up and starts leaving the Great Hall to peruse the area.
I am immediately going to try and kill Cassandra. I feel like get her before she's too powerful. I've got a feeling.
I'm sure it's gonna happen, because then it's not gonna mess up the future at all. Perfect.
Well, I was gonna say, if we attack all of them, then they won't be able to find the clues. So it really doesn't give us we don't have to go to a timer or anything.
I don't like my chances I don't like my chances against any of them in a fight. It's a stupid idea. But we are much smarter than
said all ideas any,
I don't know. I don't know. Well, then, except for the stupid ones. I don't know any of you, except Eric, obviously. So what are your strengths?
Hi, I'm Jackalby. I'm a pretty decent cook.
Strengths that would help in this situation, Jackalby.
Oh, I'm a brewer as well.
In the finding of clues, are you intelligent?
I could make a snack.
How are your grades?
My grades are good, mostly in the culinary school.
The culinary school.
Yeah.
What is your? Are you an alchemist or not?
I do. I dabble. Yeah. Mostly in edible alchemy.
You guys would have seen that in potions class, Jackalby, who has been in sort of the periphery, is quite capable, and he usually gets it right fairly quickly. He tends to be really shy and like doesn't seem to have a ton of friends at the school so far. He doesn't truck along well with the other dwarves because he's so undwarven-like in presentation. He's so wee and tiny, even compared to other dwarves. But he's proven to be pretty good at potions.
But it's okay. Like as with most group activities, I'll do it. And you guys sit back. That's okay.
No, there'll be no sitting back. We
oh, really?
We'll work together as a team. We'll work together as a team. We've got to win this. Who are you?
Oh.
Your pickles or something, wasn't it?
Pipkin.
Yeah. What do you do, Pipkin? What's your grades? What's your best subject?
Oh, I like digging.
Digging's like not a punching. Subject, Pipkin. What's your best subject?
I like cartography.
You got,
I like calligraphy.
You've got magic within you? Like
some
natural
of the
magic?
Fees. Actually, not really. I'm more of a... look, I kind of lucked out. There was a linguistics scholarship.
So all that I was over, everything you were doing that was distracting me from my studies before about talking about the magics within you, that was all because you don't have magic within you?
Well, like, when I punch people, it feels really strong, like.
That's a skill.
Like,
okay.
Magically strong.
You've heard of, like, the arts of people who are channeling, like, their vital energies or, like, you know, use ki, one might even say.
Yeah,
really efficiently. And this, you've seen Pipkin, like,
is a punch so good that all of the magic in my body goes into my fists.
Right.
Do you get it?
Understood.
I'm pretty fast too. I'm pretty zippy. And
understood.
Yeah, also, I'm on an act
for
languages.
Shut up.
Eric will pipe up with, you know, they are very fast, or like super zippy. Zippy is a good word. Yeah, I like zip.
Yeah,
zip,
very zippy. Zippy. That's what I was gonna say. Zippy.
Zip, very good. Zippy.
And
zip.
If you know the etymology of that word, you'd be even more impressed.
Yes, I do know the etymology of the word. You are.
My name is Corey.
Right.
Corian.
Dor.
Where's that accent from? It
yeah,
sounds
I haven't
very
seen you around.
But also vague.
What is your? You strike me as someone.
Oh, she's a friend. She is a family five times removed. Right, five times removed. She has a little bit of gnome in her. I invited her because I can't leave her home alone. And so I had special dispensation from the headmaster today to bring, bring family to show them what you're doing. Yeah. It's okay.
Right.
Her name is Corey Ender. That's right.
Okay. So the clue mentioned four grave sites, a warrior, a wizard, a sage, and a merchant. And we have to find the treasure.
Yes. Seems like we have to pick the most worthy treasure, maybe, of the
which,
four.
What's the first sort of instincts that ring a bell for Lyndon in this moment? Has he heard of four heads of the school, House of Hogwarts situation?
Gravestones.
So they make a... You know what? Yes, we don't need to roll for this. You know that there is a... For the black mages, typically... black robe mages, not black mages. That sounds weird. Sorry, not racist. The black robe mages. Cancel me. There is a there's a whole graveyard. There's a graveyard where they practice their necromantic arts, their necromantic arts. And so there is definitely like a plot of gravestones where they go and they fiddle about. And depending on the type of creature that they're looking to raise. There's a presumably warriors, wizards, and so on, different things to practice their magic.
Yeah, I suggest we start the. It seems as good a place as anyone there talking about literal graves.
If you
it
want
could be literal.
To dig up a body, I can do
you know,
that.
I don't think we're actually.
But
digging
I'm gonna
bodies,
say,
but...
I'm gonna say, I need a little bit more of the treasure for that agreement to work.
Let's see if we actually need to dig up anyone when we get there.
I think
also, it might be one of those,
idea.
Like, the real treasure was the friendship we found along the way.
Oh, God.
When has that ever been true?
No, that's true for me.
I mean, I could
that's
use friendship. That would be pretty valuable to me.
I'm getting up and I'm starting to walk towards the exit to go towards the graveyard.
As you do that, I might
walking...
say to Jacoby, yeah, friendship's pretty good. Have you had carrots? Just saying, and then I'll kind of hop behind Lyndon.
Jacoby's like, as she runs away, he's like,
as a chef,
yes,
you've
yes, I
chef.
Have.
you hear from a table nearby, just the whispered words of Cassandra, looking like Lilas. You feel the weight of her eyes, like as she's trying to get corral her table to get up, because one of her companions is like this enormous half ogre looking guy that's just like stuffing his face. She's like, come on. Hurry up! I will not be second best. Move it! Come on! And she looks across the way and sees you. This is before the incident.
Yeah.
Look at these.
Long ponytail.
Yeah, she has a long ponytail. Look at these losers. Do you really think you're gonna win, elves and friends? What is this? A menagerie of horrors.
We're friends now.
My Eladrin ears are also like tucked way underneath the tails, so I look human.
Yeah, 100%.
Face, move on, come on.
Can you believe this one? You don't say the second N in menagerie. Idiot.
Oh. And you hear a super confused go, Wait, what? What second end? What did he say? And as you exit the Great Hall, there is a number of stairs that lead to the floor where the graveyard is sort of pocketed away in the demiplane. As you enter the location, you find yourself in a graveyard. Be-do-do-do-do-do-doom, cue Zelda theme.
Yeah.
And here...
Everybody's just so jazzed to have been called to be grouped as friends with other people.
As Lyndon walked, he started the ritual casting of Comprehend Languages, just in case he needs to read any weird draconic or old elven or whatever on these gravestones.
Perfect. So this is where you guys are all... By the way, chat, they're all level one. This is set way back in time.
Woo!
And maybe now there's a reason why
flashback.
The icons look different. And because everybody's like, this is not together. The real icons. That's not... Corey doesn't look like this. But she does. Just relax.
You can
give
do
me a
this, guys. I believe in you, chat.
I love if people are still confused about the icons.
We're good. We're here. Gravestone.
What's going on?
We joined and someone was like, Corey's in a red dress? What?
What the fuck? I get anything.
It's her twin. It's not Corey. It's Coriander. Or Coriander.
Corey. And
or cilantro, based on where you're from.
Correct.
No, that's my last name.
Coriander cilantro.
Coriander cilantro.
The graveyard here is largely broken up into four plots. The closest one to you, so I borrowed a lot of these maps. I didn't have time to make my maps today. But the closest one to you, I know. The closest one to you has a statue in the middle of it. Clearly.
It's my birthday, man. Make some effort.
I imagine having to make an effort. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, imagine.
Oh my god.
Imagine like crafting a whole thing and catching you off guard with new maps that he's made in the last week. Yeah, weird.
Zero effort, you guys. The first plot, you can see the statue of a fighter wielding a sword that goes to his feet. The second plot, you can see the statue of a wizard. The third plot has this dressed-looking druid individual with vines growing around him. And the last one has a merchant with sacks of gold at his feet. The only information that you have is literally what you've been given. I'll read it one more time to you.
Yeah.
And you can see other groups have started coming in like, what does that mean? So I'll read it back to you, and it's up to you to tell me what you want to do.
Yeah.
Amidst the gravestones of this place lies four plots, each with its own grace. One belongs to the warrior bold with stories of battles and treasures untold. The second plot, where magic's found, belongs to the wizard now in the ground. The third is for the sage who knew life's mysteries and sought them through. The fourth plot, where wealth doth lie, belongs to the merchant shrewd and sly. To find the treasure, choose with care and search for the plot that's rare. With your wits, you must devise and choose wisely to claim the prize.
The story clearly told of searching for the plot that's rare, the treasure that's rare. Stories abound of battles is not rare. Warriors are a dime a dozen. No offense, I said to the monk. again, treasures, gold, they're abound. The thing that's rare is either magic or... you said the sage is druidic-like in the statue?
Yes, you could see that he's got vines growing, and in his hand he has the... there's a statue of a little blue bird that's kind of mid-flight, and he looks like he's talking to it or feeding it or something.
The sage knew life's mysteries.
Life's mysteries, they strike me as rare, especially if it's rare. To do with natural magics. I know some people that are a little bit nature-touched in that sense. Or at least think they are. And so I'm thinking that's rare, but being that this is a magic school, I'm wondering if the magics of the wizard is the thing that's the more treasured of the four.
I thought I was nature touched, but it turns out I was just fighting with a tree.
You touched nature.
And that's when I decided I have to cut back on my drinking. All right, who are we digging up?
Aren't you 16?
Yes, but I'm also a rabbit.
Right.
The smock of Pipkin has like so many splotches of dried carrot juice. Like, it's just ridiculous.
Dried carrot juice might not look very good.
Yeah, no, it doesn't look good. It absolutely doesn't.
just looks...
Luckily, I've got what orange fur, so...
What are we thinking? It's, it,
you're
I,
an
I
orange
think it's,
rabbit.
I think it's the wizard or the sage. Which are we leaning towards?
Treasure is also pretty rare. Like, money.
Treasure's a dime a dozen, literally. It's a die. It's, like, it's money.
But, like...
It's, money's
yes.
everywhere.
True.
The money is the obvious choice for the idiots. The idiots will go because they'll hear the word treasure and they'll go for the merchant.
Speaking of which, you see a group of dwarves that have stumbled into the... Hey, it's over here! It's right there! Yeah. He's got gold and steel and money!
Like that.
And they just charge across the... everyone out of our way, and they're just pushing people, a donkey, and they get across the way to the plot of, and they start looking around. Hey, which one of
wizard
these do you think?
Well,
Jackalby takes a few steps and gets pulled back.
Yeah. I mean,
sorry.
Is
there, no, it's fine.
Is there literally a part of the graveyard that's smaller, that's got less people in it, if it's divided by what they've done?
Right, this is a great question.
Warriors,
it could also
sages,
be a different plot.
And
like,
not one of these four at all. Except
there,
for the one that's
Give me a perception check. Sure. You quickly scan the area and see if there's one of them that has less people.
Oh, yeah, boy.
Can I do that?
Yeah. Whoever wants to, absolutely.
I'm not a smart man.
You rolled well.
Wasn't it a 20 this time?
No, it was a 10.
Good.
Half as
good. Yeah. 22.
Hey, it's
nice.
Your birthday.
It's my birthday, I'm allowed to roll higher.
Yeah. The curse only subsides for one day.
So the dwarves kind of charge like the merchant area. Cassandra's group is walking in, looking around. The one that has the least amount, the wizard and the sage have the least amount of gravestones within them. They are rarer than any fighter. They
Damn
are definitely
rabbit.
Rarer than... listen, it's that you did
what you've just done is the same as on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire.
Exactly. I 50-50 do, and I give you the two things
exactly. They debate it out loud and they go, well, it's definitely between these two. I'm not sure. I'm going to go 50-50. And then the person behind the screen goes, well, I'm going to delete the two that they know it isn't.
You know what's funny, like if you had asked before, but yes, that's exactly what went through my mind. Let me how to millionaire them. The wizard and the sage plots are definitely lesser in number.
Can I ask out of character, was it still a clever solve?
This was really good. Yeah, you guys, but like, so you know that those two are like have the least amount.
I feel like I see wizards all the time, you know?
You're at a wizard
every day.
School, but...
Wizards.
Yeah.
Oh,
that might be part
of
it.
I mean,
yeah.
But not good ones, right?
How
many people here
go to this school?
How many here have high level magic? It's high level magic.
I mean, I don't think
the
poem was about them being good. It was just about what's in their grave.
Have a look around. Split up. See what.
Let's stop talking. Let's start a digging.
Is there any reference? What accent is this?
Yeah, that's a good question, actually.
What? No.
Split up. There's no time for this. Split up.
Is there
start, looking, start looking at the gravestones for names that strike you out.
Clerics or
yes.
Religion.
Oh, yes. Healing magic.
Healing
magic is particularly rare. We haven't.
It does not
start looking
exist
for...
now, but
okay.
It used to.
I'm gonna head all towards right. This sage druidy kind of naturey part and start looking at the graves in that area.
Okay,
that's
yeah.
True. Healing magic has left the world for many years, and it'd be crazy if we saw that again. In
Eric besides you. Impossible.
Let alone two people in the one family. But
no.
That'd be unlikely.
Je refuse.
Very, very unlikely.
It's strange to happen like that.
With this, as you're looking around, you, within a flash of insight, because you do approach the sages, the last line of the poem, kind of, you're like, oh, right. It does say, and choose wisely to claim the prize. And with this, as you stumble within the section, and you figured it out because, you know, obviously, as you stumble into like the plot with the sage, you watch as Cassandra and her team walk towards the wizard, and she had the same sort of idea. Well, you know, you can hear warriors, who cares? They're just absolute dog poop. The half-ogre in a group goes, hey, that's me. What did I say? I forgot already. Exactly. So she'll walk her team over to where the wizard plot is, and you watch as the humans and the sort of loosely, I guess we're going to look at the fighter, maybe. And as you approach the plot of where the sage is, you see that there are a number of gravestones that have names on them. Please don't ask me the names. I have them, but they're not relevant.
Names?
So I
what are
say...
the names on the grave?
No,
you have them. I don't want you to feel like you've wasted your.
It's Kevin Blevin Revan Chevin. No, okay, so
Revan.
Exactly. So I will say this just to break for a second. I have written Rob, and I just want you to hate you in a way. Yep. I have written about 20 different math puzzles, and all of them sucked. So because I'm not good at math, I stopped. And I made something. I made something else, but it was like prime numbers and like X, Y.
You know what I'm gonna do? Mm-hmm. I'm gonna tear them apart as well when you give me them.
Yeah, later. Like,
Jesus Christ, the man went to an effort, Rob.
Instead,
I'm gonna be like, that's not how that works. Actually,
exactly.
I'm gonna be ruthless.
I'm gonna ask you to calculate the velocity of a stone turned to wood, and then what happens when you chuck it.
Here's one I prepared earlier.
There are 5 tombstones that are unmarked. And in a basket that sits within the statue itself, you see that there are 5 name markers. And we're going to do this because it's easier for me. Now, you guys really... Chat, you can pay attention as well. Play along. And you can pause it to figure out the sequence. And this is a fun puzzle for you at home as well.
Woohoo!
There is
puzzles.
A...
Birthday
it
puzzles.
It says... It's exactly... At the Grand Tournament, there are 5 champions who have come to fight and present themselves in front of the King and Queen. Neric the Cleric, Zerakiel, the rhymes end right there. Zerakiel the Pal, I was like, I am out of ideas.
Cleric sets up.
Yeah, Zerakiel. Please continue.
Zerakiel the Paladin, Festivus the Rogue, Ugruk the Barbarian, and Kevin the Commoner. The king, being blind, asks
Neric the Cleric, Zerakiel... It's way too fast. Neric the Cleric, Zerakiel the Paladin.
Festivus the Rogue.
Festivus the Rogue.
Ugruk the Barbarian.
I
want to
know about Festivus. Ugruk
the Barbarian.
And Kevin the Commoner.
Kevin Commoner.
The king, being blind, asks his wife, who is standing where, and she answers, because she's obviously a jerk. Neric... is not next to Ugruk, and Festivus is not next to Neric. Kevin and Zerakiel seem to dislike Festivus and are not standing beside him either. Ugruk is standing to Kevin's left. Place the placards where they must go.
All right, I got this.
Okay,
Neric
I realized
is not next to
far Ugra. Too late. I should have been writing down the names of those people.
I feel like my job is Neric. More morale based. Maybe I could
make
up some
Neric
snacks.
Is not next to Ugruk. Festivus is not next to Neric.
Mm-hmm. Keep going.
Right so far.
Yeah.
Kevin and then I missed the rest because you were talking too fast. And then Ugruk is the left of Kevin.
Kevin and Zerakiel. The Paladineal seem to dislike Festivus and are not standing beside him.
Not next to Festivus.
Correct.
I really want to know about
Can
Festivus.
And then Ugruk is left of Kevin.
Correct.
Can we have this in writing? Right.
Yes, I'll put it in Discord chat, you guys. Sorry. Good call.
I like riddles. I just anytime information is sent to me orally, I
can't take in anything auditorily.
I'm just stupid, so that's my bad.
I only play a high intelligence character. I'm actually a high intelligence person.
I got what
person.
They call dumb brain. And,
yeah, got that dumb brain, huh?
My high stat is wisdom, not intelligence.
Yeah.
So Neric,
oh
Kevin,
gosh,
and,
even
Zed,
these
and
names.
Zed are all not next to Festivus. Festivus can only therefore be next to one person, so Festivus is on the end, and Festivus is next to Ugruk. Ugruk is the left of Kevin, so it goes Festivus,
I could,
and then Ugruk, and then
some
Kevin.
Croque Monsieur's. For the Monsieur's.
That sounds delicious.
Yes.
Jackal I imagine gets... maybe Pipkin has started digging somewhere, maybe like in the middle of all of the plots, and is just like essentially aiming to dig one big hole to like eventually find something.
Jackalby has these little heating stones that he's just like, his little like frying pan, like cooking up some grilled cheeses.
Baskets in a circle or are they in a line?
The basket is hanging off of the statue, sort of holding it in one hand, and the names have been placed.
The tombstones?
In the tombs are, the tomb in the line. Sorry, yeah, the tombstones.
In a line.
In a line, correct, yeah.
Sorry, I mistook tombstone for basket.
No, you're fine.
Okay. Jackalby is doing like Ugruk a little Instagram video of cooking. It's like he cuts the cheese in half and he does like the stretch out.
Ooh,
so it's like
the stretch of the cheese. Yeah.
You know what I found out is that when you do that, you have to cut the sandwich in half, open it up, put another piece of cheese in there, close it up, cook it a little bit more, and then do the split.
All right. So there's two options of how it could be based on these clues. Yeah. It's not definitive. However, there is an extra clue that it has not been given, because it goes Festivus Ugruk Kevin, and then what's left is Nerik and Zarakil. And so what it's going to spell is either fuck ZN or fuck NZ. And given given that extra clue, it's gonna end up as fuck NZ.
Well, hang on, because Zedin is my initials, so he could really hate me.
True, actually.
Rackham could be trying to do two birds with one stone and take you both down a peg.
Kevin and Zach.
I don't know if it's just these names either, but reading them also was not processing through my brain.
You mean...
When I had begun to write them out, like write out, okay, like obviously Ugruk must be next, like we have Ugruk and Kevin as the point fix, but like I assumed it was spelt with an A, so already like looking at my notes, I'm like, no. I'm having
a
hard
I think
time.
Fuck NZ is a fair guess.
I think it's gonna be fuck NZ.
So give me the sequence. As you place the names down.
Festivus, and then Ugruk, and then Kevin, and then Nerik, and Nerik the cleric, obviously, and then Zarakil, the paladin.
Sadly, that is incorrect.
Wait,
gone.
Wow. My man has hate in his heart.
It's gone after you.
So that's, we know that the UK part.
Ooh,
is...
You guys talk. There's a huge spider on the wall. I gotta squish it. Sorry, keep going. I'll be right back.
Huge,
the size of like my
Canada.
Thumb. That's actually big.
Have to be correct.
Canada.
Which leaves only those two.
Yeah.
Nerik is not next to Ugruk.
Nerik is not next.
And Nerik is not next to Festivus.
Okay.
And I don't know anything else about Nerik. And then Zarakil is. There's only four clues, correct? Nerik is not next to Ugruk. Festival is not next to Nerik. Kevin and Zariel are not next to Festivus.
Yep.
They dislike.
And Ugruk is to the left of Kevin.
Correct.
Is it to the immediate left of Kevin?
Yes. Well, I can't say. But yes, it's to the left. Yes, it is to the left of Kevin.
Well, are you saying whether this is a stage right, stage left kind of scenario?
No, whether it's like...
No, whether it's
like from the queen's perspective,
Kevin,
immediately
like
left.
Two spaces down from on the left of. Unless Kevin, I mean, logically, there's only one other option, and it works as well. So I go Fukzn.
Wow, rude.
Fuck you, Zach. You know what you did.
As you place the tokens or the nameplates, you Cassandra and the distance. It's not here. You see the dwarves. Keep digging, right? It's just gold and steel. Just keep going, and they're just going. And as you place the placards in place, sadly, it is still incorrect. But at that moment, as you are in the right plot but failed twice, you watch as digging up. The answer was, by the way, if you care to know. And
can I have dug through?
Yeah, you watch. And I'll send you the logic after if you want, Rob, but it's Festivus, Zarakil, Nerik, Ugruk, and Kevin.
It's the third clue says Kevin and Zarakil are not next to Festivus.
Kevin and Zarakil are not. Oh! I made a mistake. Sorry.
Yeah.
you're right. You're absolutely. Give me your first solution.
Yeah,
give me your first solution again.
Fuck NZ.
Oh, you were right. Sorry. Yeah. That's actually correct. I'm so sorry, dude. As you place it correctly, right out the gate, it's your birthday. Happy birthday. I'm tired. Listen. You. I'm allowed to be tired. Two things happen. One of the tombs you watch as you place him, you see as one of the tombstones begins to sink and a coffin begins to rise from the ground. Secondly, the coffin is a large letter. You did cast Comprehend Languages. It is a giant rune, and it's literally the letter G. And as you're staring at this coffin, you watch as the lid begins to shift to the side, and climbing out ever so slowly, a skeleton with a paper that's affixed to their chest, blade in hand. I need the four of you to please roll initiative.
Croc-mos, yeah.
Hey Pickles, you're up. Hit it.
So let me know what you guys get.
I'm not gonna respond to that because that's not my name.
Alright.
And also because I rolled bad.
First level version of
it's on mine. It's me essentially. So
yeah, I think we have the same.
So Lyndon's here. Not Corliss. Corey, let me rename this to Coriander.
It's Corey. Corey.
Uh-huh. Corey, not Corey. Corey,
not Corey, because Corey is Corey. Corey and Cilantro.
The logic of Corey is Corey.
17 plus 2, 19.
All right, hang on.
And you move one lower.
Where is...
Every time.
There's Jacoby. And I need
hello.
Pip. Where's Pipkin? There's Pipkin.
I'm in a hole. That I've been digging throughout this whole entire graveyard.
Have to do a French accent. Yeah.
All right. With this, I'm going to leave Eric on the sidelines for the time being, just because I don't want to run an NPC right now. It's fine. I'm lazy. Yeah. All right. Yep. So 25 to 20. 20 to 15.
19.
Corey? And 18, obviously.
Oh, obviously. all right. Jacoby and Pipkin, what'd you guys get?
11.
9.
Perfect. It doesn't matter what characters you play. Apparently, it's pretty much always the same sequence. Skeleton will roll a 9 or a 10, so faster than Pipkin. Skeleton...
I'm in a hole.
...rises up, and the skeleton, of course, is out of Kevin's gravestone... Corey and Der Cilantro, you are the fastest to react, and you see the skeleton rising up, blade in hand, ready to strike. It seems that they have something and a note affixed inside of their ribcage. What would you like to do? Let's see if I can change the screen.
What spell do we have?
Do we have
I'll show you.
Mage Hand?
The only thing that's different about us is our cantrips. I think I have Mage Hand, you don't.
Okay. Then I will.
You'll still have the same cantrips now. We haven't chosen any new cantrips yet.
Because I didn't prepare for this special birthday one shot.
You've got those three spells.
Oh, I see. Okay. I will.
And then your first levels.
Unseen Servant. I will cast Unseen Servant to go and retrieve the letter for me.
Alright, the Unseen Servant.
Unseen Servant. Or is this before we made him? No, I
think we've always made the Unseen Servant a small Ollie.
Because we like ordering Ollie around.
Because it feels familiar to us.
Yeah.
Perfect. So with your Unseen Servant coming to life, Mickey. Contested grapple check, I guess, to see if he's able to reach inside and get the doohickey.
Oh, terrible.
It's one skeleton. How strong could it be?
I rolled a 3.
Okay.
Stronger than that.
I will roll just in case, or, but even with a nat 1, I think I get better. Okay, yeah. As he goes to reach, The skeleton's moving too quickly and it's too awkward. It just can't get in there to retrieve it. So your unseen servant appears, attempts, and fails. What are you doing with your movement?
I'm just going to step back defensively behind the rabbit.
Behind the rabbit. A sentence I didn't
expect
to hear
today.
Again,
I will remind
you,
I'm in a hole. Are you coming in the hole?
Dale, your hole.
Just the other side of the hole. I'm assuming the fighter-ish one that wants to punch things is going to punch things. So,
There, I'll put
you
in the hole.
Story.
You don't know my name, not my story.
All right, Lyndon, you're up next. What will you do?
Mage hand, try and grab the paper.
All right, same thing. It's stuck within the chest.
Well, better than the three.
Make a better than a three.
I did roll a three with a one in front of it. 13.
Oh my god!
Nice.
What am I adding to it?
Any mage hand?
I would. You know what? Nothing, because the mage hand is not exactly like it would have been a strength based thing, but like your mage hand is not exactly.
Yeah, mage hands can only carry 10 pounds of stuff.
Yeah. So let's see if
and
it's
my strength
able...
is negative.
Yeah.
My strength is about the same as my mage hand.
Negative one.
With a natural four plus some amount, the mage hand is able to go and squeeze between the ribs. It tears off the piece of paper. What's the distance that mage hand can move? 30 feet, I think, right?
Yes, I believe so.
So how far were you away from the skeleton?
30 feet.
How far are you away from it?
I have to be within 30 feet of the skeleton for it to work.
Yeah, so you make the mage hand, but then you could use, I guess, your bonus action to make it come towards you. But like, I just want to know how close you are. Like, are you within? Yeah, I guess you are
right,
within 30 feet.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
I have to be within 30 feet of the skeleton for the thing to grab. So I'm as far away as I can get within 30 feet. So I'm like 29 feet away.
Perfect. The mage hand
thing, and then I'm gonna. Well, I suppose it's an action to create it. So I guess I just grab it and hold it. But if you're cool with me using a bonus or something to move the mage hand towards myself, I'll do that.
That's fine. Yeah, I think I'm gonna make it so that it moves each time you use it. For this time, because normally it's a full action, we'll say that 15 feet. It floats towards you, carrying this piece of paper. It's halfway to you, and again. Written in giant runes, you'd have to get a little bit closer to be able to read what's written on there. Jackalby, this undead thing has sprung to life, and it is about ready to shamble forward and punch somebody in the face with its sword. What do you want to do?
Oh no, I'm sorry. Jackalby gets immediately like, apologizes. They always said I was silly for keeping it. But it's good for cooking, and I guess in this situation he pulls a jar off his thing of old cooking oil, and is gonna toss it at the creature and cast grease.
Nice. So this is a saving throw for me, I'm pretty sure, right?
Yes.
What's the DC?
Dexterity 13.
Your grease hits the ground. It's very slippery, but with a 16 minus, still enough just to get to 13. The skeleton, while covered in now glistening, it looks very shiny, almost tasty, one might say.
Shiny.
Make an intelligence check for me, please. As you watch the grease hits this thing, there's something awkward or off about it.
I thought you said awkward for a second. Oh, I have intelligence finally. Awkward. 16.
There's something awkwarder about it.
16, perfect. You notice as the grease hits this creature that it's very porous and some part of the bone seems to fall to the ground and creates a little pile of dust almost behind it.
Ooh. That could be an interesting ingredient, though. I also create the grease to be like the edge of it is just hitting, so our monk friend can run up to him.
You got it. Strategy. Where is there? I was looking for AJ. I'm trying to switch the scene to the actual fight scene. Give me a second. As I'm fiddling around with cameras. It's so much fun, you guys. I love camera work. This is why I stream, to do camera work.
Should
it's
get you in the movies.
That's it. Yeah, me in the movies. I'll play just the Terrorist number 8. Okay, let's... it's true. I don't know what to tell you. It's gonna, it'd be bang on... Okay, let's transfer, boo, to this map. Better. There we go. Okay.
I still love that transition. It is sick.
Thank you to Fizz for that. Fizz Cannon and friends. Okay, yeah. So you summon the grease. It hits the ground, and you... Sorry, Jacoby, are you moving into melee? Are you keeping the distance? What are you doing?
I'm keeping distance. Jacoby
perfect. Kevin, the skeleton fighter, will move to... you, Jacoby, you're the closest. There's somebody already dug up in a hole, but he's going to shamble forward, and he's going to try to stab you in the face.
Please don't. Wow.
Natural one. Jacoby. Come on. Yeah.
All right, Thank you.
It really is your birthday, Rob. All right, as it shambles forward, it looks and it seems to be distracted by Corliss's or Corey and Anders' thigh. Even the skeleton, like, and it misses entirely.
Does he have a boner?
It's a super impressive thigh.
Oh, my God.
Wah, wah. I take psychic damage on that one. All right, that's the end of Kevin's turn. Pipkin or Redpaw, you've dug up a pretty decent hole. It smells like carrots in here, man. And the skeleton is...
my element.
He's 25 feet away from you.
I roll around a few times.
The real treasure.
It's like catnip.
Yeah, pretty much. It's like when my pet rabbit used to just have like a freshly dug like patch and would just like flop about in it to feel the dirt on his fur. But yeah, I imagine Pipkin's head just kind of like pops out of the hole. Oh, holy shit. Leaps out. Did you say the grease trail leads to the skeleton or is there like a bit of a trail?
It's like I placed it so that you wouldn't have to run over the grease.
Can I? Because I'm imagining bowling for skeletons.
Absolutely.
I want this rabbit to like slide on the grease slick, just like with an elbow out to be like.
This is WWE basically. Sure. Yeah. As you run in. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. You can absolutely slide. On the grease
there's
and come and plumb.
Set up between two gravestones.
You yeah, there. Yes. What's your entrance music? Yeah.
Okay, we don't want to get struck, guys. Not like this mother's about to.
You pig. Thunderstruck.
Wave my little paw. And that is. That's a 19 to hit.
Absolutely. You guys watch as the. The shambling skeleton comes out and leaping out of the hole, quite literally, covered now in partially grease, shining, and carrot juice comes flying elbow. Pipkin, roll your damage, please.
Yeah, it's Pipkin Redpaw. You better believe it. That is 6 damage.
And it's bludgeoning damage, right?
Yeah.
With one fell swoop, Pipkin comes flying, and the skeleton shatters and explodes. It is sundered, it is broken, and it is no more. As it breaks, however, it is not the sound of bone that clatters, but it explodes in a poof of powder, white, off-white powder that hits the ground in a small clump.
It's not it.
When they said find something rare,
did they mean the powder?
Mm. I'm going to grab at the powder with my paw, and I'm going to rub some into my too long rabbit teeth.
Oh my gosh.
Okay, as you're,
taste it.
You're getting juiced up in here. No, you get in there.
You're
and,
getting juiced up in here.
It is really, really dry, so and you instantly, ugh, it's flour. It tastes just like flour.
Baking ingredients.
What does this taste like? Oh my god, sorry, Bowser. What does this taste like? What a cake's made out of?
Oh, let me.
Yeah, rub it into your gums, Lark.
No, it's flour. Come on. What is this? Amateur hour? Okay.
We're at a ingredients cemetery.
And we treat them with respect, okay? All right?
So this thing is made of actual flour? Can I ascertain?
Yeah, but it is. Your grease hit it. You don't need to roll. It's flour. You know what? Just to make you feel. You know what? Roll. It's a very high DC. Roll.
There's a lot of different types of flour.
Roll.
I have cooks utensils. I have brewer supplies. I have alchemist supplies.
Does it have gluten matrices in it?
Yeah. Go ahead and make a little.
That's a.
Natto 20?
12. So
that's not enough. You don't know. It could be cocaine, dude. it's
back
just
up.
Do it.
Everybody back up right now. It's flour, and with the way that the discoloration in the gums of Pipkin's teeth and the way that it looks. Yes, it's definitely. In fact, I think I made a list of what the ingredient is.
Is it wheat flour?
And you know what?
Wheat. It's self-raising.
This is flour that's made of, and it's a little bit dark, but somebody somewhere collected the horn of a unicorn and ground it down and then used it to make the skeleton out of it. This is ground down unicorn horn flour. It's very rare, very expensive. Possibly flour. One of the three ingredients that the headmaster was looking for.
Does anyone have any vials?
Probably. I'm a bit of an alchemist.
Jackalby goes through various different... he's like, I guess I'll have to pour out my tarragon.
I don't even pours wear out. Pants.
Pours out a thing of dried herbs and scoop some unicorn horn in.
I don't have any pockets in this
dress. I'm going to look at the paper that my mage hand stole.
And since you still have detect languages, it reads in giant the following. From flames of red and gold, I emerge. With strength and grace, I do converge. A symbol of hope, a new beginning. My radiance is truly stunning.
All right, well, we had a good
from
run.
From flames of red and gold, I do emerge.
We did it.
Flames of red and gold, I do emerge. Something about strength and grace.
I do converge. Well, a symbol of hope, a new beginning. My radiance is truly stunning. Here, I'll put it in Discord.
Hope and new beginning. Hope and new beginning.
Can I throw a little bit?
Can you throw? Sorry, you want to throw up a little bit? Is that what you said?
No.
Why are you throwing flour at me?
Because you're red, right? Like the poem said.
Yeah. So I thought maybe if we put a little bit of flour on the dress, maybe it was referring. Maybe they knew you were going to wear that dress.
I do not think that is the case.
The giant G on the top of the coffin was just as an indication that this language was going to be giant.
Sure. Yes. In fact, on the back of the paper, there is another G on it.
The same G, same rune.
Same rune, but maybe even printed from the same stone that would have had the rune on it, just like sort of fixed on it.
I think
it is leading us to the next location.
I think so, yes.
I was going to say, what if, and hear me out here, what if we bake it into bread, right?
Ooh, I could get on that.
He seems pretty good at baking.
I have a sourdough starter.
If the clue led to that, yes. If the clue had any indication that that's what we had to do, then that would be a good idea to do it.
We still have two other things to find. Potentially maybe. It is a recipe.
The G stands for Galibrary.
Or the Great Hall, potentially.
Great Hall. Well, the gardens.
Because it said garden. Reborn in fire, and if this clue is about flour, what do you do with flour? You put it in an oven.
It didn't say anything about being reborn in fire. It said, from flames of red and gold, I emerge. That's nothing to do
with... Like, but it does have to do with the phoenix.
Like a loaf does.
Great Hall did a really good job
of hitting things.
Great
Hall makes sense.
I'll call on you when we need to hit something again.
Let's go to the Great Hall and see with their fires in the Great Hall.
Mika, you know what? Jackalby? You are Jackalby? Let's go high especially you possibly can today. Make a history check. Jackalby.
Ooh, look at that. 18.
Very nice. Listen, the dwarves here, part of their craft and part of what they do is runesmithing. This is an ancient dwarven tradition where they take magic. They're not necessarily all wizardly and scholarly. There's a lot of unexplained mysticism. There's a lot of tradition. I'm not going to get into the whole history of runes and runesmithing, though we can. We could spend an hour talking about it. Check it out on our next podcast. But there is a forger, there is a blacksmith that exists within the confines of the tower. It is not like the blacksmithing room, but within You know for a fact, you don't know where exactly it is, but you know that in the staff area, sort of like that mini series of buildings or village that exists within somewhere in this building, Wayreth, there is a smithy or something that is used to forge. And if you're looking for heat, presumably that might be the place.
Forges are where things get born from.
That is actually a good point.
I've actually been working on something recently. I am going to. I'm going to get to the edge of the graveyard. I'm going to try and get out of sight of the other competitors if we can.
The graveyard. Sorry, keep going. Yeah.
The good graveyard. Yeah. And if I can get out of sight of the other competitors, I'm going to turn my book to...
They're all staring at you. You guys just fought something and you collected something. They're all staring at you. So, but you could try to find a spot behind a tree, let's say, sure.
Can I distract them looking our way?
You can if you give
Corey
us...
Corey and Cilantro has a very scandalous dress on right now.
Is she going to dance? Mm.
Sure.
Give me a performance.
Say yes.
Give me a performance.
This is a flashback. Let's do
this. This is a flashback. This is Gerudo Valley's playing in the background for our Zelda fans. Go ahead and give me a little performance check, please.
Performance check. Okay. Please roll well. Ooh, 15 plus. What is our performance?
We had a couple of
things. Play that on saxophone.
What are you? 16.
As you step into the center of the graveyard, your foot hits the ground and it draws the attention of everybody. As somewhere in the distance, Jacoby and Pipkin, with the beating of Pipkin's foot on the ground and Jacoby's instruments, you give us a performance that will be spoken of at least till the end of the day.
Nice.
And everybody's staring enough to
create... You remember when that sexy exchange student came for a day? Danced in the graveyard randomly.
Danced in the graveyard.
That was wild. And the graveyard, it was wild, dude. yes, you find yourself a little corner where nobody's paying attention to you anymore and everybody's staring. I will do this. I need you to make... It's a great performance. I'm going to make a little insight on Cassandra as she's looking at you. Okay, I rolled an 8. She
perfect.
Who'd have thought that'd be a downside?
She's attracted to me. That's what it is.
Yeah, that'd be a twist.
She
too sexy.
She's looking and she's looking around. All right, whatever. This is terrible. Where's Lilas? You hear her say, "Where's Lilas?" I don't move. You stupid oaf! And somebody's directly in her way between, staring at you, causing her unable to spot Lilas, and that you take that moment, Lilas, and you disappear from sight. What do you want to do?
I've been working on a spell recently. I'm getting okay at it, called Create Bonfire. Hoping that one day it'll come in handy in various different methods. Hmm. I am going to create a smaller bonfire as I can, just to have some flame, and then I'm going to hold the paper close to it and look through it as if like, because I'm wondering if what it's saying is from flames I emerge. I'm wondering if, like, the actual clue that we're looking for is going to emerge from the flames.
Imagine if that was that simple. What kind of...
I'm just saying.
What kind
of
brain-dead dungeon master would do that? As you do this, it sucks. I hate it. But yes, there is a map that literally shows you Wayreth, the small town, and it has a dotted line that leads you to a location, particularly in the town. So this is a map to the location you need to go to.
Does it lead us to the blacksmith?
And in fact, if you decide to follow it, which I'm not going to decide for you, but it looks like it would be leading to a big old icon of an anvil. And if you guys want to go there, I could take you there. I can show you the world.
Well enough, and I'm like, yeah, that's the one. And then I'll crumple it up and stuff it in my pocket.
And you turn back to see Corey doing the push.
We've all snuck away.
Sexy dancing in a graveyard on top of a grave.
Where did she get the maracas?
I think those are just bones. I think they're little. I think she's taken a lot of bones that have fallen on the ground and is shaking them.
You guys forgot Eric the gnome is with you. He's literally the glee club captain, and he's probably sitting there with maracas, and he's like, he's doing it.
He's rocking that tambourine.
That was so good. Oh my goodness.
Enthusiastically.
That was so good. Your legs for days. Very nice. And so with this.
We need to move.
Thank you.
I
know where the next location is. It's at the, and I'll throw them off. What else is in town? A candlestick maker?
Yeah. There is, yeah, there's like, there are countless rooms. There's like Cobbler. The potion room. There's literally any location you can think of.
The butcher, the baker, and or candlestick maker.
I'm looking for something. I'm going for something that's in the, not like if the blacksmith where we're going is at like 12 o'clock, I'm going for something that's like at 3 o'clock, something okay. In a completely different direction, but not like
so the way
the
that would
direction.
Yeah, so the town itself or this location exists within a room within the tower, right? The tower itself has like these different pocket dimensions. You can name any pocket dimension. They probably have, there's probably the dimension of shrimp somewhere in here, so name anything that you want to make up and you can send them there. That's fine, or you can say it out loud.
Do it.
The red district. I know
mind
the next
you,
location is.
Rob, I will say this. Yes. Whatever location you're about to make up, and I want you to make one up, might come back later to bite you guys in the ass. Just so you know, if you establish today that there's a dimension of bagels, perhaps later Lyndon and Corey might suddenly find themselves into...
Make a dimension of murderous psychopaths.
Yeah.
There's no way that could turn against us.
I'm glad that you clarified.
It's in the dimension of lawful good mercenaries that are
benevolent mounts. Then we will always have a horse to ride. Do it.
The dimension of
fun fact:
creatures
benevolent
that
mounts
are in love
is actually what I called my not safe for work adult show.
Benevolent mounts.
Chippendales were calling me. They were like, we need a new name for a show. I was like...
Benevolent Mount.
Do it.
So where do you send them? What do you say aloud?
I got to duck to the loo.
What do you say out loud?
All right. Lyndon is a bit of a pranky dude. Isn't he? So he would go it's going to... Like, my first thought is to send them to, like Nickelodeon slime dimension. Like
sure.
The slime dimension. Right. So he says, I know the next location. It's in the it's in the swamps of Eastwood, Eastridge or something.
Perfect. And with this, they're like, the oozes. You hear the dwarves? Hey, they found it. Let's go kill some oozes. And with that, the dwarves just take off running. Every time they hear anything, they just instantly. You see, two dwarves stay behind though, and they're like, hey, what if we just keep digging? Maybe there's steel here, right? Like, let's just get back to it. So have the dwarves take off, a couple of them stay behind, because they're, you know, there's gold or steel to be found here, platinum.
Yeah,
who knows?
Golden in there.
They're going. They're digging. Make a deception check, and it's going to be contested by Cassandra.
Ooh, not bad. I'm good at deception. It's one of the things I trained in. So that we could pass off as Lilas. 16.
Okay, I'll roll out here. Sorry, I've been rolling, and I want you guys to be able to see what I get, and also for the audience. Okay, perfect. You head off, and you follow the stairs that go to the next level up in the tower, and you know there's the pocket dimension. People are running around. It's not just, you know, the students that you've seen and not seen are also looking for these ingredients. They want whatever the special prize is. And you stumble into not Hogsmeade, aka Wayrith.
To know,
not Hogsmeade.
It's a weird name. It's a weird name.
I know.
It's called Hog's Breath.
And as
Bog's Feed.
As you
Dog's
arrive,
feet.
Bog's Feed.
Bog's Feed.
Nice.
As you arrive, and we could skip a lot of these clues that I've laid out because you found the map. You stumble into dwarves arguing about the anvil and the forge being closed, and that's really bizarre and unlikely. But you follow the directions on the map, and as you do so, passing through the cities, the streets, the buildings that are about, in this version, because this is in your memories still, Corey, as you're laying unconscious in Sabian's house, there are things that obviously weren't there. There are ghosts and spirits that are coming by. There are monsters that certainly were not there in real time, but in your memory at this moment, sure they were there. And eventually you follow the directions and you arrive in front of a door. An anvil stands there, and there is a wooden frame with six holes that are vertical, so from top to bottom. Again, in front of the door, there are six There's a basket. I love baskets today, you guys. And inside of them, there are six. There are six ingots bearing different runes. By this point, your detect languages, I think Rob would have faded.
Yeah, it's gone.
But there are six runes.
Again, as a ritual, but it takes time.
And each of one of these runes has a particular sigil, and I'm going to put it on screen, and I'll share it in Discord as well, but I want the audience to play along. Give me a second.
I know a few languages. Will that be able to help?
Tell me what they are.
I am just having a
Dwarvish, Elvish, Sylvan.
Common, Elvish, Halfling, Sylvan.
No. You, I mean, I could tell you, these are giant runes.
Mm.
And does anyone speak giant?
As in this, oh, okay, right.
No, as in the actual giant. Yes. Yeah,
maybe some language. Fucking idiot. Sorry. She's feisty today.
Get him. She's coming at him.
I don't know. Who would ever waste time learning such a useless subject like learning how to speak giant? Where has Jack will that be just, ever got
just
anyone?
A tear just down his face. He doesn't know why.
I thought you said that you know languages and linguistics.
I will let you guys just... All of
Do
you can
I
make...
know every language in the world? No.
You guys can all make an intelligence...
Giant's a fairly common one, though.
You can only make an intelligence check, yeah, for sure.
I can't wait to make this with my minus intelligence.
Nice job.
You 20?
No, 17.
Good.
18 for Pipkin. I'd just like you to know.
Jack, just straight intelligence, yeah?
Straight intelligence.
22.
Wow.
I was doing ring, so that's less.
Jacoby, what'd you get?
Yeah, that'd be a
3.
Yeah.
11.
Okay. Surprisingly, Pipkin and Lilas, less surprisingly, you recognize these runes. These are giant runes, and you know what each one of them is, in fact. There is in that list, here, I'll give you the translation in... there is... The runes are as follows. Sky, Uvar, Ise, Ild, Stein, and Haug. And all of them are... I'll tell you the names, what they mean. Stone, frost, cloud, storm, fire, and hill.
Is the names of the types
that
of giants?
That was quite quick.
Yeah, I'll put it in Discord here.
Great.
These are the names of the types of giants, the true giants anyway. No, it doesn't count ogres and trolls and such.
All right.
So there's a bit of meta knowledge involved here, but that's okay.
You can call me out on meta gaming if you want.
Oh, it's totally fine. It's totally fine. Like I assumed
that Lyndon would know this stuff.
Yes.
What are you again?
This is probably talking about the we just have to put them in the order of the ordning, presumably top to bottom. It could be in the form of. Totem poles. Totem poles, the most important person is actually the one on the bottom because you're the most likely to see it and so they're the most detailed. Whereas most other things read top to bottom in order of importance. Do I get any indication from the door or how it's laid out that it wants the most, the highest one in the ordning at the top or at the bottom?
No indication in particular.
It looks like they're all the same size.
Correct.
Ingots.
The runes are all the same size ingots. It's just you have to place them.
Which direction do giants read?
Good point. Which directions do giants read?
They read left to right and top to bottom. If this were let's say the Japanese.
Is then.
Okay, so
they read middle out.
Middle.
It's a lateral language.
What's that movie where the aliens show up and they talk in
your
circles?
Your eyes literally have to. Like,
can you guys? Would you guys remember that? Is it? It's not contact, but that
word is back and forth like this.
That's why everyone thinks giants are stupid. It's just because they read.
Like they just keep having to go out and then cross-eyed.
Once they get to the end, they cross over and go back, and one eye goes up and the other one goes down the page.
It's gonna bother me. There's a movie that's about this, right? Like where the aliens come and they speak in circles because they complete the full sense.
Yeah, Arrival. Oh, Arrival.
Yeah, Arrival. That's it. Yeah. But Zach,
it was less comedic in tone.
Yeah, yeah. But Zach, you,
I thought it was out.
I laughed the whole way through
that movie.
Yeah. And Zach, you speak giant, so you should know. But yeah, so what do you put at the top and what do you put at the bottom, Rob? I guess.
Storm at the top, hill at the bottom.
Okay.
Cloud is second from the top. Then we go stone is second from the bottom above hill. And then I always get frost and fire mixed up. I think fire is slightly smaller, but they're actually higher in the ordering. Frost is next. So from the top to bottom, it goes storm, cloud, fire, frost, stone, hill.
And as you place the final stone, the final ingot inside the door, the door swings open.
Rob went outside in. Unconventional for a giant.
And standing inside of this chamber, as you're the first to arrive, you see sitting on a throne a diminutive form of a giant. A fire giant. Is it an illusion? Is it actually here? Hard to say, but he is rather small and sitting on a throne. And as you enter, its head tilts towards you. A face covered in the mask of molten lava, crisscrossed with interwoven fire. Its eyes blazing with light.
Welcome. You have successfully arrived at my forge. I have many treasures here. Weapons, steel, gold, gems. Whatever your heart desires. What is it that your heart desires?
And you can see in his room, there are frying pans, there are tools, there are weapons, staves, there are chests. There's this forge behind. No carrots! There's a forge behind him as well, and there's an anvil. Yeah.
We're looking for ingredients, rare ingredients. A symbol of hope and new beginnings. Something with radiance, strength, grace.
He doesn't would answer.
What kind of... I don't twin speak. But I turn to Lilas and I say, what kind of a weapon would be both strong and graceful?
Rapier, swords. Swords of finesse quality.
Something that would be radiant damage.
I'm going to go up to the forge. Is there anything still in the fire? Damage.
Yes, there is a blue flame that's within it, and you can see at the heart of the forge a small burning egg?
Ooh.
Phoenix. Is this a phoenix egg? Ooh.
It's an egg. That could make a mighty omelet.
Is it a phoenix?
Unicorn phoenix.
And if we baked some of the unicorn bread...
Ooh.
We would need egg.
I think maybe
we could have a mighty croc monsieur on our hands.
I'm thinking the treasure that they're pointing us to is some kind of breakfast sandwich. We've solved it.
Yes.
Scrambled eggs on toast.
I'm sure it is. I believe the can I do any kind of a check to see if I would recognize this egg as any kind of mythical creature?
Make a nature check.
Not the worst. 13.
I mean, it looks like an egg that's on fire, but not cooking.
What is the egg sitting on now? It's like just in the coals of the forge.
There's a lot of dust. There's coals that, you know, charbon. What's it? Carbon. What's in English? I think coal, right? Charcoal.
Charcoal. Yeah.
And it's bright red, but this blue flame that sort of sits within it, it's just like. There's, you know, the bellows are not active. This thing is just as if a source of eternal fire.
I will, if you are allowing us to take any treasure, we'll take the egg.
He looks to you, and you hear him say, the second riddle was to ask for permission. Oftentimes, magic is a fickle thing. And certainly the power of asking is often sufficient. Yes, you may take the egg.
Thank you.
And with this,
I'll cast Mage Hand.
the mage hand picks up the egg, and it is now in your possession. As you have...
Do you have anywhere we can put a flaming egg in your belongings there?
Do you have a bag that is protecting the fire?
Yeah, I mean, I have a frying pan. I won't cook it.
No cooking of the egg yet. We don't know what the ingredients are for.
I'm going to hold it in my frying pan.
So, you see... So
he's going to scoop up some of the coals so it's nice and toasty.
Give me a perception check, please, Zach.
Fire is hot. You might have observed.
Seven?
It's enough. It's not really hard to make out looking in there. You just didn't roll a nat one. You go blind for a second because you're staring at the flame like a bit of an idiot for a second there. But behind the coal, you see that there's something written. You pick up the egg. You have it in your frying pan. You don't burn yourself. But there's something written behind the hot coals. You could take the time to move it around and see if you want to take a look at what it says.
Nah, I'm sure we have enough. No. he's going to use the bellows and blow kind of the dust away. To kind of unearth it.
Cool. You see there are two giant runes inscribed there. Two letters. The letter A and the letter G again.
Gag. Gag.
The Gforge.
The Gforge.
Were we meant to be taking note of all the letters that we've encountered? All right. You don't
G's. It must have been G's so far. It's relatively easy to remember. Two letters.
Gag.
A and G.
You say that.
We've got G, G, A, and G.
Gag.
G-gag.
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 Okay.
Excuse me, sir. I don't suppose you have another riddle for us, another clue to where we're meant to go next? You have
yes. Been... Yes. The next clue is, please get the hell out of my forge. Thank you very much.
Okay, so what could it mean?
Going to hell, maybe.
Too much for asking nicely.
There's nine hells. There's nine hells, and get the hell.
And as you are, he begins to rise.
Okay, all right.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Technically, we're taking the heat away from him, so maybe the heat is hell, and we're taking the hell away.
Hey, look at that.
Get the hell away.
That's lateral thinking.
That's smart. That's what we've got to do. Leave the forge.
For no particular reason, who's the first person out of the forge?
Probably
Carrot. All right.
Carrot.
Carrot. As you step out, Pipkin, I need you to make a perception check, please.
Okay, I perceive that my dog Pickles. Is an annoying asshole.
I love your dog.
Yeah, okay, you can live with him.
I would love to.
All right. What's that? I rolled a 16. 18.
18, perfect. As you step out of the forge, you see a shadow that looms from above your head, and you see it as you and the rest of your friends, step out of the forge. You see a red... shadow that is swooping down immediately towards Jackalby, claws outstretched.
And it's a hawk! It's an eagle!
An imp
the mother.
Has been sent. An imp right here, who was waiting, cleverly hidden. Lyndon, Lila's. Give me a... It doesn't take much, but just give me an insight check, please.
Insight.
That's so funny. Ooh. Can I give an insight?
Yeah, actually, you would too, for sure, because you know her.
Because it's definitely going to be better than a nat one, but still not great.
You've got the insight.
Three. A nine.
Nice. And what'd you get, Lila's?
Nat one for a total of two.
Well, who the hell could have possibly sent this imp? Who knows? You don't know any necromancers or warlocks. We don't know who would truck with the devils and demons of the abyss or the hells.
We actually don't know any warlocks.
Not yet. but that's to say that maybe she was already mucking around with it back then. So with that, I'm going to ask all of you to please roll initiative. And because Pipkin spotted it, you have advantage on your initiative roll.
Yeah, that's not funny. I lost both of my uncles to swooping.
Ooh, both of my uncles to swooping.
To swooping imps.
Well,
All right.
From a rabbit folk. Okay? And hawks and eagles are our biggest predators.
Swooping is the largest swooping cause of death amongst Harrigan.
We should do a PSA, like, you know, that goes black and white.
Motor and vehicles.
and carrot overdose.
To be fair, if you actually look at all rabbit Harrigan deaths, it's probably being eaten by their parents. If they're anything like actual parents.
Dark. That got dark. Okay. True, though, but dark. So, Corey, you rolled a 19. Pipkin, what did you get?
They don't.
Oh, shit. Was this initiative?
Initiative with advantage.
Guess who rolled a natto 20?
Is it you?
Probably you. Give me context clues. I'm going to say you. Sweet.
Jacoby, what'd you get?
Let me check.
Last in games.
You're correct.
Yes, in games.
Jacoby, what'd you get?
I got a 15.
15 and Linda.
Also got a 15.
What's your modifier? You guys can sort it out between yourselves who goes first. I don't much mind.
Birthday boy.
Yeah.
Perfect. With this top of the round, Pipkin, you watch as the imp is about 10.
I got a 21.
Yeah, she rolled a nat 20, right? What was your nat?
Natto 20 was from Ellie. I rolled a 21.
Oh, yeah, but what was your total, Ellie, after...
25.
Yeah, okay. So then...
I'm a speedy boy.
Perfect. So yeah, I heard what you... So it goes, Pipkin, Corey, Jacoby, Linden, and then the imp is dead last. So Pipkin, as the imp swoops down from above, you watch its claws outstretched towards the frying pan that Jacoby has with the egg inside of it. Something or somebody has sent this after you. It's 10 feet up in the air. There are plenty of walls to parkour off of or things to jump off of. What would you like to do?
Yeah, I would love to use my rabbit hop to bop it out of the sky.
Hell yeah. As you use this is a 3x a day thing feature, right? Rabbit hop?
Two currently.
Twice, perfect. You jump up in the air, make an attack roll. As you try, are you trying to pull it down or are you trying to punch it?
Yeah, maybe I'm trying to I'm trying to, because again, rabbits they can't grab so good. So I guess I'm just trying to scratch it and really fuck it up.
All right, go for it. Make an attack.
However you interpret that.
I interpret it as you scratching it and messing it up.
I'm scratching it downwards. Ooh, that is a Bowser. That's a 19.
Absolutely hits.
And my hit is +5. Cool.
Let me check. 24. I guess that'll hit.
It's fun to be a zippy little murder boy. Six damage again.
Six damage, perfect. As you jump up, you watch as you scratch and punch it. It doesn't. You hit it, but it's not quite as damaging as you would have hoped for. So it's resistant. No. That's fine. But it's in the air. I'm gonna ask you to do a thing. If you're trying to bring it down, this is going to be a little bit difficult. Make a make a contested athletics. If you're willing. If you fail, that means you fall and you're going to fall prone. If you succeed, you're taking it down with you and it is going to be down with you. Are you willing to take that gambit?
Absolutely. This is a one shot.
Go for it.
Stakes are so high.
I am not attached to this character.
Yeah.
He is a rabbit. And I love Watership Down, so you know how much I love, short-lived
perfect.
I'm gonna take this Watership Down.
What did you roll?
Yeah! That is 17. Athletics.
You die. Corey and Lyndon's backstory is darker than we thought.
Mine is 17. -2 is 15. As you grab it, you yoink it down, like a fat pigeon that is now beneath your feet. Pipkin, Redpaw, you've captured the imp. Corey and Der Cilantro. This is a mouthful, dude.
You're welcome. Corey.
And Der.
And Der.
Yeah.
Cilantro.
I'm going to call you Cilantro. Basil, you're up.
Easy.
Okay. The imp is beneath the herring gaunt's feet. Basil. I'm sorry. I apologize. Basil. Was that Fawlty Towers, right? There sits the imp. What would you like to do?
I'm gonna shoot it.
With a gun? With what?
With a gun.
With
I cast manifest gun.
Did I have this at first level?
Say hello to my little friend.
Didn't I?
What's that? Missile? Yes.
I did. Magic missile.
Nope.
I mean, come on, Rob, can't you do the physics?
I have frost fingers. I did have that one.
Magic missile. So rolled your 3d4 plus 3?
No, not magic missile.
We're just trying to work out which spells I had.
I've got them down here. You had frost fingers.
I had the same as you. Okay, frost fingers. I'm going to cast frost fingers.
Okay.
Freeze
the void. Avoid the harangan.
Yeah. Or not.
15-foot
cone. I mean, I cannot stress it's a one-shot, guys, so...
Yeah, but canonically, Cory hasn't killed
anyone.
Never killed
anybody.
Because I freaked out the first time I did.
So Frostfingers, you mean like...
Can't kill you,
is this Frostbolt?
I'm still going to cast Frostfingers.
No, it's a...
It's maybe you don't count me as a
relatively
person.
Newer spell. It is on D&D Beyond. It is an official one.
Oh, there we go. I got it. Yeah. I make a constant.
It's like perfect. It's basically burning hands, but with cold damage.
Yeah.
Constitution saving throw.
I rolled a 6. I think that's gonna suck.
Whoop, whoop.
So you rolled 2d8 damage, right?
Yep. And this will also hit pickles.
Pipkin.
If you roll a 16, you might kill her outright.
2d8. 3.
Let's hope.
It's 2d8.
And an 8.
So 11 points of damage. The imp woof, disappears and is unmade, sent back to the Nine Hells or wherever the hell it came from. Pipkin, how many hit points do you have?
Why do you need to know?
Because you just got blasted in the back, so you need to make a constitution saving throw. What's the DC?
14.
You need to roll a 14 or better, or you're about to take 11 cold damage to the back.
Can I give advantage or help by showing some thigh?
That's worse. That would make it worse.
Distract from getting out of the way.
All right.
Anyway, I rolled a 17.
Okay, so you take 5.
Yeah, let's go.
Thank goodness.
So you take 5 points of damage.
Pipkin's so family damage. History.
No, you watch as
he doesn't want to die via swooping.
Pipkin's tail is like frosty at the bits, at the tip, but. The imp very quickly is dispatched and leaving behind a puff of sulfur and smoke.
I see just too late what spell Corey's doing, and I know it's like an area of effect, and I go, Corey! And, no! Be careful with the... let's get out of here.
With this, you have retrieved...
You didn't try and warn Pipkin.
Two of the three ingredients have been collected.
Woohoo!
At that moment... The lore master that has been taking notes and following you undetected lets you know that the third ingredient has also already been retrieved by another team.
Sandra.
And you are to return at once to the Great Hall.
Okay. Fight it to the death. Let's do this.
Yes.
Kill her.
Kill her.
Yeah.
To the death.
Is this where we cut off her ponytail?
No, that's gonna be in the prequel thing if we get there. Surely.
This isn't the prequel thing. This is something different for your surely. Birthday.
This is just fuck around, yeah. You know.
Yeah.
This is just fun day.
I don't feel well. I can't feel my tail.
Jacoby looks and there's just no tail. Oh no, it's fine. It's fine.
It's like frozen off.
Yeah.
Just
he goes pom-pom, to just look at it.
There's
and
a frozen pom-pom on the ground.
It's fine.
It's fine.
What was that? It sounded bad.
Just a little bit of icicles formed on it. You just might experience some numbness on the old tail, but should be feeling new very soon.
Jacoby, why don't you kiss my icicle?
You've got ya. Sense of humor still that didn't freeze off, huh?
You hear the lore master when he hears you say this kind of, all right, that's 10 points from not Gryffindor.
we did the most of our proper nouns just got knots before them.
Yeah, it's kind of wild.
Weird, isn't it?
No, it's a school for not wizards. No, it's a prefix. What you don't understand
is
not.
It's because the school that we go to is called Notwats.
Exactly. Oh, okay, that makes sense.
Here back in the Great Hall, you see that one of the cauldrons that sits at the front, where I'm sure things are fine, there is an ingredient that has filled one of the cauldrons already. You watch it is burbling and gurgling, and inside of it, the scent of various spices, yeast, sugar, something else that is emanating from that cauldron. The other two remain empty. And with your arrival, the hall falls silent, and you can see on the side Cassandra and her team waiting there, looking proud as if they've achieved something. But you, as you step in, the hall again falls quiet, and the voice of the headmaster. It is said that you have retrieved 2 ingredients. Is that true?
I mean, I can count again if you like. It's... I know we don't study mathematics here, but we've managed to retrieve 2 of them.
Present them.
I present the fry pan full of burning hot coals and the egg.
You also have the flour.
Very well.
Oh, I also have the flour. And the little flour.
Is there unicorn bones still in my teeth?
Yeah, that's it.
I also have the tail of a rabbit folk.
You should keep that. That's considered very lucky.
Oh, that's so weird. Where did you get that from?
From a different place. Just from a different town.
My cousins from Canada. You don't know them. They have
you're
a rabbit tail.
You're lucky I rolled low on perception.
And there you're invited to come towards the front of the stage where the other students are watching. The dwarf's still in the graveyard, by the way, digging up. They found nothing so far. So far, no luck. And as you're approaching the front, you see one final thing as Cassandra has a piece of paper, much like you guys have found, GGAG. On hers, though, you see 2 other letters. Who's leading the charge? Who leads the way with the ingredients? Is it Jacoby? Is it somebody else?
I mean, Jacoby has the ingredients, but Lilas is the one who's the brains of the party.
Sure. You see the letter C and...
Well, can't be.
Well, let's say that all of you can make out the letters C and B.
Yeah.
On that piece of paper. Yeah, and she's looking at, she's like, what could that mean? What did they find something? And she's looking, she can't quite see what you guys have found.
Oh, God, I know what it is. Ugh. Ugh.
What?
The happy Raga. Birthday song?
It's the musical notes of happy birthday, you fucking asshole.
Yeah. I did think that when none of the... Yeah.
What? Are you talking, possibly talking...
like a G.
What?
Yeah.
The headmaster's very confused about what you're talking about. The headmaster will look and say, you have retrieved all 3 ingredients, but there still remains the secret incantation that must be... said aloud. And since you are the self-designated, you are the...
because it's not your...
Oh, man, should I run downstairs to get my ukulele?
Lilas casts sleep on themselves.
Lilas.
So they don't have to listen to the fox.
The headmaster looks and says, since you have so carefully been careful to tell us you're the brains of the operation, you're the leader of this little group, I fully expect you to please recite the incantation that I'm sure you've deciphered, please.
You better hope I never come to Canada.
It's on site. It's on site.
It's on site. Can we hear the incantation? Let me turn down the music. Let's just take a listen. Let's just take a listen to this incantation, chat.
Silas realizing
just do
what
the
it was.
Letters, though. Don't do this.
Sings G G A G C B.
Well, and you hear the headmaster go, you know, this is a really awkward song. Like, the incantation's a little bit off, and it's really poorly.
I think it must be in the wrong order because nobody in the right minds would.
Terrible.
Because the C should. It's like the emphasis is on the wrong word of the.
I mean, only if you can't sing. But
I mean, it is genuine. And as you finish. The incantation, the ingredients, 3. The egg, the flour, the spices combine in the end to make... Nobody saw it coming. Nobody figured it out immediately. Nobody picked up on this.
Oh my God, it's going to be a cake.
It's a wish spell. No. It is, in fact...
A birthday wish spell.
A lovely, enormous pastry that stands tall in the midst of here... It is important to celebrate our victories. It is important to celebrate our survival from the cataclysm. It is, and with that, interrupting, the headmaster is about to launch into a speech. You hear the screech of Cassandra again being bested.
Oh my god.
Again being upset by what has just happened. I formally demand, Headmaster, a duel. My companions, we have been cheated. Lilas has called in an outsider, obviously some kind of con woman, has distracting everybody with their dance moves and just legs. Just put them away. Put those legs away, please.
So they said violence was not out of the question.
I agree, says the headmaster.
Someone having a sexy slit up their dress. That's what we draw the line with.
You are, as the headmaster immediately interjects, because really he likes a good fight. He likes a good fight. May the spoils go to the winner. Remember, once they're knocked out, we do not finish them off. Do you accept the challenge, Lilas and friends?
I'm fighting
these people. Let's dance, mother liquor.
What? Yeah, what he said.
Metaphorically dance, like in a combat way, you know.
To date, headmaster.
The mother liquor thing.
To date, I believe I have beaten Cassandra at every possible grade that you've ever thrown at us for any test so far. So
that is true. That is actually Cassandra. You're a bit of a dullard sometimes.
I suppose combat is inevitable one day. I suppose we might as well give her a fighting chance, as it were, by turning away from academia and...
Begin! He interrupts you and instantly shouts, "Begin!" And the Mortal Kombat music kicks off. I'm going to put you guys in position. Give me a second. You're going to fight in the Great Hall.
Here in South Australia.
Initiative?
Yeah, we're going to roll initiative, yes. Absolutely.
Yes.
The movie.
So we have...
Mortal Kombat's a game.
Where's Lyndon?
Oh!
Give me a second,
Holy shit!
Pipkin? Where's Pipkin?
Yeah, you better work that out.
And on the other side, hang on.
Birthday boy rolled a natto 20.
Natto 20! Every time you roll a nat 20, an angel dies. No, it's fine. That's not what we expected. Rude.
And I say good.
You know what? These angels
good
suck.
Good riddance to them.
Many of these feathery bitches out there, you know?
Feathery, yeah. Sorry, if they've never known life, how can they know death?
Got him. That guy, wow, Pipkin got deep.
Existential.
He's deep in his carrot juice right now.
He's lost in the carrot juice.
Let's do this.
Pupils the size of dinner plates.
Where's my ogre?
And he's already a rabbit giant. With really big eyes.
We'll use this buddy boy. No, we'll use this guy. Oh, there we have company just in time.
Oh, Eric.
Eric's here. Give me a second.
Eric, thank you've goodness. Been uncharacteristically quiet this whole time.
You also have a French accent.
Yeah, oops. Or something harder.
All right, give me a second. Let's get...
Can you do a French accent, Dred?
Bonjour. Bonjour, oui.
Put a little more escargot in your mouth.
You can do a French accent.
You have to get the mouth posture as if you are always posture, smoking like a this? Cigarette.
Oh, always. Oui, oui.
A little bit at the front.
You know that does
come to a no, up here.
Things oh, immediately oui. Perfect. Hydra.
Now that we've hi.
Welcome in. Perfect time. Like,
I'm a Frenchman. I'm a Frenchman.
It's a me, Frenchman.
It's a me, Chris Pratt.
Exactly.
I like a baguette. It's a me, Mario.
All right, so you're here in the nick of time. Initiatives, you guys. Let's roll. Tell me what you guys got. Let's 25 to 20.
22 with an
ooh, 20. Nice. 20 to 15.
16.
Okay. 15 to 10.
11.
13.
And I guess Eric
Eric got a natural one for the total
roll.
Your first roll.
First roll, yeah.
Good. Welcome.
That is how you say, not a good. That's not French. Sorry, we tried.
That's just like a Italian. You know what? Eric's Italian now.
We were doing Mario, so that's where I went.
Yeah.
Baguette, Gérard de Pardieu. Exactly, that's it. Fou de Fafa is a great song. Let me just roll for Cassandra. Oof, that's terrible.
Cassandra,
I don't know pop culture references. I live under a rock.
I'll send you Fou de Fafa by the
flight. Fou de Fafa is a classic and a banger.
Which is why I probably don't know it.
Why to become gods?
Just imagine that AJ Winters landed on a spaceship during COVID.
All right. Top of the round, Lyndon. Wow. As the headmaster calls, fight, begin. Let me change the music to make it more of a banger because you guys are fighting. And just to know, before we get into this, this will be the last thing that we do. At the end of the stream today, we'll be raiding into, I think, AJ's channel somewhere. I'm not sure exactly.
Rob's channel.
Stick around.
For a birthday stream.
Rob's birthday stream. So feel free to stick around. Obviously, and vibe and celebrate. I will have to run pretty quickly, but you guys are all awesome. Lyndon, top of the round, it's you. There is Cassandra. There's a half ogre with her and two wizards, one dwarven and one human that are flanking her. And she's looking like she means the business as she wants the birthday cake.
The business.
Lyndon is going to reach immediately down into the pocket, make eyes with Cassandra and say, "You remember that time you beat me in enchantment class?" And then cast Hideous Laughter and try and get her to laugh at how absurd it is that she would beat me in enchantment class.
All right, so what's the DC?
That's so funny. And
what's
mean.
The DC?
I kind of forgot what little pricks the twins were.
Yeah. I'm glad that he gets to play a little bit more of this kind of a role because when I invented him, he was like, oh, he's going to be a little bit of a prankster. Little cheeky, little prankster.
Is Lyndon the Chad at Wizard School? Is that what I'm understanding?
The Chad that's also bullied. School. Yeah.
I rolled a 3, so I don't think that's good enough.
Yeah. Nice. 13 was the DC. So she is. She considers the idea of beating me in any class absolutely ludicrously funny, and she falls prone in a fit of laughter. She is incapacitated and unable to stand up for the duration, and she can
repeat
she
the same through the.
Oh, here. Yeah. If a creature of intelligence score of 4 or less isn't affected. So she should be fine.
even Eric pulls out his cigarette because he's French.
That's my character, right? I'm controlling that.
Rock and forgot that drug.
You're back. Lyndon, go ahead. So she falls down, she's laughing.
Falls prone, she's incapacitated. She gets to repeat the save anytime she takes damage or at the end of her turn.
Perfect.
That's my action. Bonus action is just to sort of pace around her struttingly.
So you move up?
It's a word. I'm not going to be like adjacent to her and any of her cronies. I'm staying away from them as much as possible, but I'm just kind of like strutting my stuff, being like, look how good I am at magic.
Nice. All right, the Mick Jagger walk. Perfect. Corey and Der Cilantro, you're up next. What are you doing?
Thank you. The group of her party, where are they at?
They are...
Would you say they're in a 15-foot cone?
They're 50 feet away from you.
I'm going to get closer.
Are they within a 50-foot cone? Two of them are. Right. One of them is a little bit further away.
Okay.
Here at Not Hogwarts.
I am going to... Do you have that chart that shows me which spells I had in the level one?
Sure do.
Dankeschön.
These ones are the ones you didn't have. These ones you took later.
I did have
You definitely had cause fear.
Yeah, I'm going to cause some fear.
Okay.
I'm going to show too much of the sexy slit. I'm kidding.
Turns into a screaming hell
pit. This is
that's what
PG
I call
10.
Mine.
This is a Christian Minecraft server. We established this as a Christian Minecraft server.
I'm gonna cause fear to one of her cronies.
What's the range? Team.
60 feet.
Okay, so you're fine. Which one do you, there's a half ogre, there's a spellcasting wizard, human, and then there's a rune Would-be runesmith dwarf in the back.
The half-ogre that is holding a giant rock that it could throw at us.
Perfect. What's the DC?
I like to think that the entire session, every time we've seen them cut away to the ogre, he's just been walking around with a giant rock over his head.
wisdom 14, please.
He fails. As he's standing there, he sees Cassandra fall over laughing. I don't understand. And he suddenly is beset by, like, his deepest insecurities. They're all laughing at me. Okay, so
I like that the fear he has is of being laughed at.
Being laughed at by Cassandra.
Totally justifiable.
Target must succeed on a wisdom saving throw. It will become frightened of me. Can't remember.
So he can't, he'll have disadvantage on any attacks. He can't move willingly closer to you. Can't all of those things.
Yeah. Yeah, he can't move willingly closer. So I'm going to take a 10. I'm going to step 10 feet forward.
Nice.
Yeah.
And every eye in the hall lands on you.
On my thigh.
on that's it. Just that one corner of your thigh. People are like, damn, that's a thigh. All right, Pipkin, Redpaw, you're up, and Jack will be your next.
Okay.
This is only a year ago to the date, right?
Yeah.
So you're 18.
Yeah.
Cool. No, we're 21.
Oh, no, we're 21. He's 19. That's right.
Yeah.
So who have we still got in play? I can't see the...
So you've got Cassandra's knock prone. The half-ogre is scared, but you know they're still there. And then there's the human behind them, and then there's the dwarf further behind.
What? did we say, like, what is meant to, like, decide this combat?
Knocking them out, apparently, or until they give up. Traditionally, it's either you knock them out or murder. But, it's just a shadow.
I mean,
Cassandra's
the leader. Because she's prone, can I kind of just jump on her and start wailing?
Yeah, 100%. No, you would know. Maybe you wouldn't. You're still level one. You could do, and you would have advantage because she's prone. She's unable to defend herself. And I'll tell you that if you land a hit while she's under the effects of hideous laughter, it's going to be sort of like a coup de grace. It is a coup de grace, rather. It is like an automatic crit.
Ooh.
Let's give it a go.
Because yeah, I think... Canadian.
Then we'll hold her down and cut her ponytail off.
That is a 14.
14? Is that with advantage?
Oh, no, sorry.
It's okay.
Yes, it is.
Give me a second. Let me actually have to bring up her stat block.
I reckon. Roll better.
Whoa.
Okay. Don't worry, Rob. I will definitely try and implement
with
that advice.
Her spell.
Up, do or do not. There is no.
You
spell.
Do land the hit.
That
her
is so
AC
untrue.
Is 14, even with her poor attempt at mage armor. You land a hit. Roll. So you do.
Nice.
This is a crit.
Ooh, hell yeah.
So your first die is max. Roll a second die to add to it.
Cool beans. When you say the die is max, do I also add the damage to that one?
Yeah, so basically you roll, it's what, d6 at this level? So it's you do 6 plus your...
Just a d4.
Oh, sorry, 4 plus your modifier, and then roll another d4.
Cool. Great. That's 12 damage.
Oof. You feel something...
From a rabbit's claws.
Yeah, you feel something break. You punch her. Where do you punch her? In the face, in the ribs, in the leg? Where are you aiming?
Does Cassandra have any notable scars on her face?
We're about to find out.
Let's go. To quote, is it John Mulaney? I'm gonna it's like a phone book, right? I'm hitting her with a phone book, so I'm not leaving any bruises.
So you don't leave any marks.
I'll hit her in the chest.
Perfect. You hear something as you pummel her. One of her ribs. One of her ribs, literally breaks beneath your punch, and you hear her. She needs to make a wisdom saving throw, you said, Rob?
I really hope she keeps laughing.
She gets to make it with advantage because it was triggered by damage.
Natural 2 or 16. 13. She stops laughing pretty quickly. It's horrible. Like, for people watching, there's this person on the ground laughing, and then you walk up and you just punch this person as hard as you can that's laughing.
She's just kicking her in the ribs while standing.
And there's blood that gushes out of her mouth, and suddenly she stops laughing. And she looks up to you to...
Is she justified in hating us?
Yes.
Oh, God.
That's what we're learning.
She looks up at Pipkin with a very deep hatred.
This is so much worse because it's before they know that healing magic exists.
Yep.
So they're just allowing students to break each other's ribs to the point of unconsciousness. And
she's not quite unconscious.
Hope you recover from it.
But she's not doing well. All right, Pipkin, you've attacked, you've moved. Anything else you want to do? You can bonus action.
I have good berry.
You have bonus action unarmed strike as well. So if you want to follow up with like an extra punch, you can.
With her.
Yeah, she's still on the ground. It's not a crit
Knock
anymore. She's not incapacitated anymore, but she is on the ground and still prone.
All right, yeah.
Punch her in the face.
Okay.
Kick her in the throat.
To quote my character sheet, I have said. I've said, by living among violent people, I have become desensitized to violence.
You know what? To Perfect. You, Pipkin, her blood looks like carrot juice, dude.
His back leg starts thumping to alert his new friends to the fact that there is carrot juice in the air. another attack, you say?
Yep. At advantage
okay,
again.
That is 18.
You hit, roll your d4.
So yeah, I think two things
Six damage. The first punch, or the first kick to the ribs, breaks the ribs. She spits up blood. The second punch across her face knocks her out, and you see a tooth flies, her front tooth. Her big front tooth comes flying out and hits the ground, and she is knocked unconscious.
Whoa. Human so teeth things. Are so much smaller than Harangon teeth, I'll tell you what.
I think Pipkin got kicked out of school after this, which is why they aren't part of our backstory. Yeah. And secondly, I think the tormenting of Lyndon and Corey got worse because of this.
Probably.
Over the last year.
Which is probably why we then...
Because we mocked her for the tooth.
Eventually got, yeah, we probably mocked her for a tooth until eventually she it got so bad of her bullying us that we were like,
to cut off
her head.
Of, yeah.
Gappy no tooth.
Jack will be, you're up.
Jackalby,
Goose.
Zach-y. Oh, that's me.
Yeah, Zach-y. That's you.
Hello.
Zachalby.
Too busy laughing at your own joke.
My mum used to call me Zachalby. Can I see?
I thought she was called you Gappy No Tooth.
My mom was a jerk. Really she just mom. Used to tease the hell out of me. Yeah, she used to bully me. Sorry, go
Before
ahead.
Before my teeth had grown in. So are they I can't quite see the our enemies, but they're three of them are standing in a line, I think.
Yeah, they're more or less in a line. They are
Can I get over to the left and then not all the way up to them, more like to the corner of the tables so that I can see them all in a line.
You have a 30 feet of movement, so this is about as far as you can get.
Yeah, about there. Perfect. So then you see, Jacoby's going to take that giant, keg off his back and he's like, in non-dwarven circles, dwarven ale is actually only legally allowed to strip the varnish off boats. as he shakes it and cracks it, he is going to cast, Tasha's Caustic Brew.
Yeah.
A stream of acid emanates from you in a 30-foot line, 30 feet long and 5 feet wide in the direction you choose. They also have to make dexterity saving throws.
I'll give you a little bit. So two of them, you can hit two of them. You're too far away to hit the last one. You hear dwarves that have now returned. We found steel! Where there was steel! We found it! And they're so excited. They see, hey, oh, that's Caustic's through. That's Caustic Brew, that is. So what's the saving throw?
DC. They need to make a DC 13.
So the half ogre has disadvantage because he's scared and he can still see the source of his fear. Pretty sure that's how that works. That is a 3. That's a failure. And then the human that's behind rolls a... I have not rolled above a 10, you guys. That is another failure. All right, both of them failed.
It's been a pretty bad day for you.
It has.
On their turn...
You're so mean.
Happy birthday.
On their turn, they'll take 2d4 acid damage.
Perfect. I love the fact that I'm going to clip you singing happy birthday, by the way. it might just be my new sub alert for like a week or something.
You hate that song as much as I do.
It's terrible.
It just doesn't bother you as much.
It's terrible.
You think it's a terrible song, but it's awful. Just not,
you can inflict it on others, like I am. You know.
But I made you do it. All right. You've moved to use your action. The half ogre at the beginning of his turn. Then will take roll 2d4 damage. Then please, Jackalby.
That's 5 points of acid damage. So it can either take an action to like wipe the acid off it, or it can just like live and let live, you know.
Live and let die. The half ogre, does he get to make a saving throw because he took damage, or is it just at the end of his turn? Let me just check.
It's the save you're
You have to, a creature has to use its action to scrape or wash off the acid.
Yeah, I was looking at the fear.
At the end of each turn.
Perfect. He's going to use the rock that he has to scrape his body. He's literally going to be like,
ow!
You watch as he peels a fine layer of skin along the way.
So I've done a bit of chemistry. So in labs, like just as like an emergency thing, you've got the eye wash stations and stuff, and they've also got like a giant rock. If you ever get acid on your skin, rocks are the best way to get acid off.
They were great exfoliant.
I mean, if it was a sponge, I'd understand. Like a hard rock sponge.
I mean, I definitely use a volcanic stone to wash my face, and that is not even a lie.
Yeah, that's the thing. I use nothing. I use nature, and that's why I look old. The half ogre will then take a step back.
Scrape away all the old skin.
My nails. I use my nails.
That's it. He rolls an 11 minus. That's still a fail. He's still scared. Eric! Eric, you have arrived.
Is Cass still up?
Cass is unconscious. She's gone. She's
unconscious? Okay, yeah. Cool. I'm going to look at the ogre and I'm going to say, hey, you, ogre, your mother, your father was a hunter. Your mother was a hamster and your father smelled of elderberries. It wasn't good. I tried practicing.
It was very good.
He's working on it.
I'm kind of out of my element right now. There's birthday cakes, apparently.
Good. Yeah.
Your mother was a hamster, and your father smelt of elderberries. Yeah.
It sounds very Scottish.
Yeah.
What?
And I'm going with Scottish, and that's, you know, Scottish French.
Listen, Eric is a very talented actor, so he could do any voice he wants.
Yeah.
Let's see where this accent goes.
It's a little vicious mockery. Is a what?
Yeah.
Wisdom.
Wisdom. Yeah.
Also, what do you think
DC
is the last
is
word
of
that?
12. Ooh, I rolled a 13 minus 1, 12. Is that good?
That's a meet and beat. So, yeah, you meet and beat, which means that...
The half-ogre retorts to you.
Okay. My mother was not a hamster, but my father did smell of elderberries. I miss that smell. Delicious.
Aww. He misses his dad.
My father, let me sit in my backstory. Yes, my father is deceased. It was very, very tragic.
I'm gonna like take a note down of like that was flash not forwards. A good did the ogre, accent.
Did the ogre
not good.
That we killed at the Battle of High
That's
Hill,
not the same one.
It
not,
could be.
No, it's not the same one.
He had acid scars on him. I'm pretty sure.
He smelled of gooseberry and lilac.
Okay. Gooseberries. Oh yeah, yeah. I am then look over to the birthday boy and say, "Hey, you." You're doing great. I've changed accents. I'm committing to this. You're doing great. Happy birthday. And I'm going to give you a bardic inspiration.
Perfect. The wizard thug, whose turn it is, will see Cassandra down. I can't do anything about that. I don't know healing magic, but I know how to cook rabbit. He will point
is
the
finger. Take 2d4 acid damage?
He is actually sorry. He starts the turn by burning to death. Probably roll your 2d4.
Well, I can't do anything about that.
That's 3 points of
what
acid damage.
What I do
damage.
Know is how to cook a rabbit.
This hurts, but you know what doesn't hurt is delicious rabbit stew. He's gonna walk up to you with burning hands. He's gonna reach out to you, and I need you to make my dear friend. I think it's a dex saving throw. Let me double check. It is make a dexterity saving throw, please. The DC, I'll tell you, is 12.
Oh. A rabbit stew joke. How original. Like I've never heard that one before.
Yeah, no one in her family is even called.
You failed?
I failed, yeah.
How many hit points does our buddy still have left?
I failed by one, which sucks. Yes. I have 4 HP.
The Burning Hands spell does 3d6, I'm pretty sure.
Could still survive.
We're gonna roll one die at a time. Let's really milk this for all it's worth.
216 chance.
I trained.
Instantly, the first d6 does 5 damage. You guys watch. And this is and this is why Pipkin is no longer in any of the adventures. That's because at that moment,
at this point, you roll the other two time, dice anyway. Because if they're both sixes, you might outright kill him.
Pipkin, there's a six, and another six.
So 17. What's your max HP?
What's
your max
HP? 13
or less?
9.
Your max HP is 9.
As you,
these guys just murders somebody in front of the
walks up
faculty,
aims his finger, and because he's a newbie, he's a beginner caster. He doesn't really know. He doesn't have a really good control of the arcane. Here's what happens. He casts Burning Hands over Cassandra. It catches the ingredient that's behind the spices. React violently to the flames, egg. And the little bit of left, the residue that was left that didn't make quite end up in the cake, explodes into fire. The headmaster suddenly, enough! With the waves of his hand, you watch as this buffeting wind stills the entirety of the fight, and standing sadly, now remaining as burning and scalded and smoldering and delicious smelling, not gonna lie, with a hint of carrot in the air, the remains of Pipkin. We barely knew ye, Pipkin, Red Paw.
And pour now, one out for Pipkin, guys.
Pour one out for,
so much darker.
Corey's gonna wake up from this flashback next week and be like, oh my god, do you remember Pipkin? Be like, I can't believe I just...
And as Pipkin...
You see Jackalby turns with the frozen tail and he's like, I can rebuild him.
This is when Jackalby becomes an artificer and...
Dr. Frankenstein. Yeah.
But here's the deal. Actually, it's just Pipkin casts Wild Shape into a roast. And all that's left is sadly,
even though I'm a monk, I cast Wild Shape.
That's it, into a roast. Sadly, as the fight comes to an early conclusion, you've been declared the victors. Your appetite probably gone. But
or
maybe not.
Hear me out.
You are declared the victors today of the day of celebration, the day of remembrance, the day that the headmaster again pointed out, as the other faculty are coming up, pick up the remains of Pipkin and take them away to who knows what. Maybe the necromancers have a new thing to play with now.
This school is fucked.
Yeah.
Blackroom's a bad school.
This is why we wanted to start the blue robe.
Yeah, this is why we're like, none of these people are okay. Because the white, the headmaster's a white robe.
Yeah.
He let it happen. The black robes are going to probably reanimate her and play around with it. And the red robes, nobody trusts them.
You hear the voice of one of the mages that's not far. That same skinny sort of human. This Raceland guy who... Headmaster, if you don't mind... I think I have some ideas, too.
Ugh.
And the headmaster, Raceland, your overbearing, over-exuding confidence is insufferable. You and I shall have words at a later time. And you watch as Raceland kind of, Raceland looking sort of still cocky and self-assured, sort of sits back down, showing a little bit of disrespect. This guy is capable. One of the best wizards that you guys have ever seen. He's a year older than you, but his magical abilities are ridiculous. In any case, on this day, it isn't about them. It isn't about Red. It isn't about Pipkin. It isn't about.
Write that
down. I was going to say Raceland's.
That's going to come back to haunt us.
Oh, Raceland is like a dude in Dragonlance.
Yeah, that's going to be like an enemy that we'd come up with. Hey, foreshadowing.
Raceland, is
Riesling?
Raceland. He's definitely R-A-I-S. A dude.
Raceland.
A nice Riesling with some roast rabbit.
And his buddy Pinot Grigio are just vibing.
Excellent.
You have been
A+.
Declared the victors today, the day of celebration, the day to remember that while the rest of magic and the towers have fallen, And while it has taken the shape of a cake on a silly little quest to celebrate one of our students' birthdays, it is important to take a moment to celebrate what victories we have, what we can achieve, what magic gives and what it takes away. And with that little bit of last sentence remaining behind of what it gives and what it takes away, we fade back to Corey on the wet, cold floor of Sabian's house, coming to more fully. You see Lyndon, who's looking down at you, concerned. And Lyndon, you well know, and you remember that moment, that today is your birthday, which also means it's your sister's birthday. And this is maybe not the best way you had intentioned of celebrating it, but she is alive and she is well. Take it away.
Hey, wake up. I think we're safe now, and I think it may not be the perfect time for it, but I got you something.
What?
It's our birthday today. And I will put my hand in hers. And you feel something hard and kind of cold, just a very small thing. And then as I pull my hand away, it's a tooth. It's a front tooth of Cassandra. And I picked it up from the floor on that day.
This is incredible.
We will get the rest of her in time.
I want to... Ooh, can I... What is pressure?
Did I miss? What?
We bust Cassandra's teeth.
I beat Cassandra with my little rabbit paws and knocked teeth out.
I take a thread from our blue cloak and I start weaving it into like a necklace.
You're gonna wear Cassandra's tooth around your neck.
Wow.
Yeah. Why not?
Why not?
Your lust for hatred of Cassandra means that there's already a casualty from it.
And with this, I'm gonna switch us back to the other scene. I'm sorry you just came at the tail end, Red, but I'm happy that you.
No, that's fine. I'm just happy to be here.
Let's do this. As Lyndon hands over the front tooth of Cassandra, which she obviously had replaced, and you know, her tooth is now like one of her teeth is a little bit different color. Like you'll never match exactly the other tooth, you know. And so it's like it's a little bit wider than the other teeth, and it's always you know to look for it.
I definitely pointed that out a lot.
And you do know, and it occurs to you that Cassandra also has, strangely enough, part of her outfit has always been some trim-lined fur. For a fact that,
that's dark.
That Pipkin may or may not have ended as part of her outfit one of those days. In any case, we will end it here. Today we're ending a little bit early. I hope you had fun. I hope this was a little bit of a, I did tell my chat that's going to be a special, Dragonlance episode that is really, not about the story, but more about the characters. And I think we kind of got there. So with that, chat, let's all wish Rob a happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Are we going to stop making coats out of people? Is that what's happening
That's
here?
Exactly you could do happening. Like the whatever the, I don't do the Chuck E. Cheese one, but there was one.
Happy birthday to you. Perfect. Yay.
Happy birthday.
Stevie Wonder. Happy birthday to you.
To Jack Black's Peaches, but it's just happy birthday.
Happy birthday. Happy birthday.
So.
Happy birthday.
Anyway,
that's very good. If you guys want more of these sort of prequels, this was like sort of for Rob's birthday. We were fundraising. We are at $100 of $200 for like the first prequel, which might be the twins, might be Goose's background, might be Ollie's, might be Juniper's. But if you know this sort of,
I don't think it's gonna be Juniper's.
Why not? It could be. But if any, it could be. If anybody's
Farming Simulator 100.
I really want to play that.
But you know what, it's not that simple. It's not that simple. There are people that hunt on your land that shouldn't be there. There are things
also,
that are
like
diseases
in date.
And you had a romance with Godswin. You know, there's stuff happening. Your brother has been a pain in your butt.
Do you want to play Godswin?
So somebody could play Garrett. Somebody could be Godswin. Who knows? But Chet, thank you so much for being here. Let's go around the table one more time. Dredd, since you weren't here before, I'm going to start with you. Are you? Where can we find you?
First off, happy birthday, Rob! You can find me on the channel Dreaded GM, where I run a bunch of cool things, including tomorrow night, I'll be running Horror on the Orient Express, our very first episode. Last week, we met the players. I'm super excited. And tomorrow, we are going to be leaving the station and in seeing what is exactly going to happen in this module. It's very fun. What else? Getting close to 1,000 subscribers on YouTube. That's very exciting. I think we're up to 705 now. So only 295 if my math is sound on that one, Rob. Let's hope so. But apart from that, I'm going to let this move on so that they can get to that birthday stream.
Cool. Let's go with I feel like I'm always picking on Ellen. Ellen, why don't you go next?
I'm sorry, Pipkin died. I'm incredibly... No!
I like Pipkin.
It's brilliant.
It's great.
It's what had to happen. Yes, does it make more trauma for Lyndon and Corey retroactively? Yes, which is what I'm here to do in this game, is create more trauma. Hi, I'm Ellen. You can find me on Twitter at EllenKGraham1, where you can see all the streams I'm in. But make sure that you follow and subscribe to Roll to Cast, the TTRPG podcast. That's ROLE. We have 8 seasons of content, so have a listen and tell me which one's your favorite. I've been pour one out for Pipkin.
Pour some carrot juice out, boys.
This is probably the last time you'll ever see him.
What's that saying? No one important died. Wow, rude, chat, rude. Jeez, this is not uncalled for. Zach, who's now sunken a little bit deeper in his chair, there he goes. There he goes. Yes, I know it's late.
It's me,
Mario. Hello. Tell me about yourself, Zach. I've never met you. Nice to meet you, dude. What's going on? Who are you?
It's been a pleasure. Zach speaks giant and all the things. Write it into the internet box. You'll see a YouTube channel where I share silly D&D stories and silly D&D posts and thoughts of my own. I Speak Giant is a podcast that I have that has been going for quite a while. I have 2 campaigns running right now. One, which is the heroes post offices, and the other, which I flagrantly ripped off The Mummy, starring Brendan Fraser.
Is it actually pronounced Brendan Fraser, or is it Fraser?
It's Fraser.
Uh-oh.
I think it's the one I said.
I'm Brendan Fraser.
I've heard him say the latter.
He's wrong.
Yeah, but like,
it's different. It's a different.
Some people don't pronounce their name right either.
Like Corey
Ronan.
And Ander.
Yeah, she's wrong. She's the one who's wrong.
Well, thank you so much. Let's go around the Corey. AJ, tell us about you.
Hello.
Yeah, hello.
Hi, my name is AJ Winters. I am a dungeon master and world builder from Winter's Tales. This is my studio behind me, the first one in Australia, Dungeons & Dragons. Woohoo! We play on Tuesday nights in a completely homebrew world, the Chronicles of Aelwyn, which this dude has been guest starring in for 2 weeks and is in the final guest starring spot for next week.
Is there a birthday scene? Is there like a singing happy birthday?
No.
We should make that happen.
But my cast did sing happy birthday to Rob yesterday.
Nice.
And because they're all musical theater people, they harmonized, except they harmonized and made it a minor song. Like, they changed it into minor, and it became creepy as fuck.
Yeah, I believe it.
And unfortunately, we didn't film it.
Yeah, it was in the after while I was cutting the cake. I was like, probably should have filmed that.
Yeah.
If I was any good social media, I would have done that.
Nice.
That's great.
But yeah, that's me.
Cool. Rob, happy birthday. What about you? Who are you? And where have we seen you before? I'm sure I've seen your noggin around the internet before. Where have I seen that?
Good word.
It's all over the places, this noggin. My name is Robert Hartley, GM. I am a full-time dungeon master, professional TTRPG player and nerd. And I am all over Twitch and YouTube. Robert Hartley GM, and you can also find me as the Dungeon Master for a comedy group called Viva La Dirt League on YouTube,
What?
Very fun, it's a very short actual play D&D, so you can keep up with it week to week.
Thanks.
That's about it. Stick around, because we're going to be raiding into my channel to do a birthday stream where I'm just going to hang out and chat.
So thank you guys. I hope you had fun. This was a little bit unusual, but you know, it's fine. It's fun times. You know, I'll say shout out, AJ reached out saying, hey, did you know? And Fancy reached out. They were like, did you know that it's Rob's birthday? I said,
yeah,
no,
we didn't coordinate or anything.
I don't know. I don't keep track of people's birthdays. No, I didn't know that it was his birthday. I'm sorry. I don't have it in my calendar. And like, yeah, should we do a thing? I'm like, all right, we'll figure something out. And they were like, let us know because, you know, and I was like, oh, fine, fine. So we put this together. And it was like,
I don't give a shit.
It's not like I kicked down your door. Stop. It's not birthday. You better do something.
And it was like, fine.
How can I be clear? I don't care.
I sent Malcolm a bunch of different pitches. I was like, so we could do this. And if you're not keen or don't have the time, how about this?
And I was like, it's fine. Thank you.
You care so much?
And she said,
Fancy messaged me. Fancy was like, you're here for Rob's here for you for his birthday. And I was like, okay, well, he's going to be in the studio. I'm going to make it a big deal.
Like, we care. Can we pretend like we care about Rob's birthday and not that not that everyone else has pestered us to do something?
No, it's fine. It was fun. And it was a good challenge to come up with something in story. And I think we kind of gathered some. I'm pleased with how it came out. And I hope you guys had fun. And
it was very good. And the puzzles were very fun. Thank you for that. Okay.
And I had a bunch of math ones that I just didn't.
They weren't mathematics.
I had so much fun, guys.
I'll send you the math puzzles.
You did so well, Dredd. I really love the French
accent. The French accent for the most part was really good.
They tapped into the character. The
started going Scottish towards just the very end.
The math puzzles that I had for you, there were the rows. They were like two rows of five tombs each, and it was like the number of x plus y equals 13, but one is to be even, one has to be a multiple of this. What's the solution?
Wouldn't have been made for good content on a stream.
Yeah, and I was like,
now, and I'll do it on the after chat for
I'll have to dig it up. But it was like Jesus. It was some math. It was like, oh my god, I'm bored just writing this. So I stopped. I'm done with this.
Why would anybody find this interesting?
And I was like, I know who. And then I did a prime numbers one, and I was like, Rob loves prime numbers. I was like, I got lost in prime numbers. I was like, I'm not doing this. It was like 10:30 last time. I was like, you know what? I'm going to bed. Anyway,
you just gotta make a bunch of clues with binary, because
that's it. 01001
binary stuff.
Binary's fun.
I should have done that with binary's letters in hindsight for the happy birthday.
I like it.
Also, half of today's stream was Rob solving puzzles and the rest of us riffing, because this was about Rob doing the puzzles.
Yeah. So just on my end, I'm off tomorrow and Friday, no stream, womp womp. Back on Monday morning, and I've just started. Just next week, first episode, Monday night, 6 to 9 p.m. EST. So if you're in the Eastern Standard Time Zone, come and play or come check it out. We have a guest player, Tsukiyuki, who is brand new to D&D. She has played once or twice before. I'm very excited to get a new player in. So come out and hang out, so it's not just me and Tsuki, but you know, come and support maybe a new time zone. That'd be nice. And that's it. So we're going to raid. Rob, are you live? You're muted. Oh, 1 second, please. One moment, please. One moment, please. All right. Let's keep vamping. So, chat, thank you.
I think I remember enough Italian if we want to do happy birthday in Italian.
That's you, if you want to.
Tanti auguri a te. Tanti auguri a te, tanti auguri a te, tanti auguri a te.
It'd be crazy if Italy was real.
It would be that'd so be wild. Fucking crazy.
So, you know, now we have twin speak that's made up, and then we have Italian, I think. Italy's Italy's is made up as well. It's crazy.
Yeah, let me roll to see if I can understand the Italian.
You're streaming. Perfect. Joyeux anniversaire, Rob. Let's head out of here.
Change your title. Oopsies.
Chat, thank you so much for the follows. Thank you for the subs and stuff. I appreciate every one of you. You guys are wonderful. Uti, thank you for the raid earlier. I completely missed it. Sorry, I was really deep into Monsters and Mayhem. Thank you for the raid as well. Reminder for the contest next week on Saturday, the video will go up. There will be 5 Easter eggs hidden throughout it, actual physical eggs somewhere on the stream. For a few seconds at a time, find them, email me. I'll put the description and the information at the end of the video next week, so look for that. Email me at the email that'll be listed with the times, the timestamps and or the screenshots of the Easter eggs, and you will win yourself a Tails Power code. The first one to get it wins a code. That's it. First person. So be on the lookout for this. Chat, stick around for the raid. Thank you so much to everyone. Robert Hartley, GM. Why can I not type your name? I always add an extra E. You know that?
Because Rob's name doesn't actually exist. Do. It's like Italy.
A lot of people do. it's heart with heart like a deer, not heart like an organ.
Sorry, exactly. Do you mean Rob are you spelling or Roberto?
Roberto.
Thank you, Rob.
Sorry for those of you who just got here, Rye Hope and Time Doctor and Imran, thank you for all the follows. You guys are wonderful human beings. Take good care of yourselves. Happy birthday, Rob. Let's go over there and spam our favorite raid emotes. Until then, what's the thing we say, Zach?
Goodbye forever. See you later. Good-